Evening, everyone, and welcome to the Village of Lisle Planning and Zoning Commission meeting of October 20th, 2021. Director Smetana, if you could take the roll, please.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Here.
Commissioner Trussell?
Here.
Commissioner Biederstadt?
Here.
Chairman Zeidel?
Here. Before we get started, I'd like to amend the agenda. If I could have a motion, please, to move item New Business A, PZC 2020-14, to the end of the agenda. This is the zoning code rewrite project, so if we could do that last, moving up the administrative appeal and the concept proposal, and then doing the zoning code last. If I could have a motion, please.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And that motion passes. At this time, we do general public comment. General public comment is with respect to items that are not the subject of a public hearing. Tonight, we have one continued public hearing, and if there's anybody in the room that would like to make public comment on a general topic that's not the subject of a public hearing. And I see none. Moving on our agenda to meeting minutes, can I have a motion, please, to approve the September 15th, 2021 Planning and Zoning Commission meeting minutes?
So moved.
Second.
Anybody have any comments?
Due to the fact that I was not present at that meeting, I'm going to abstain from my vote. That's why I didn't second it.
Okay, well, good thing Commissioner Bauer just arrived. and any other comments? Okay, can I will go ahead.
Sorry, I'm late. I do have a couple minor corrections. Page one, section three, approval of meeting minutes. item number two, I still think this is not correctly stated despite my attempt to correct it last month. On page five, comma, second to the last paragraph, comma, should state, quote, Commissioner Bauer said it was referenced that there was, I think the word no should be inserted, staff point of or for security. That's my recollection of the way that the project architect described that topic. On page two, under staff presentation, both the second and third paragraphs, there's a couple of instances where the word insulation, as in like, you know, heating and cooling insulation is used, and the word should instead be installation, as in to install. Bottom of page three, the heading is staff presentation, but I'm sure that is intended to be applicant presentation. And I think the only other, like, really, Mr. Smetana, I can give you a handful of other nits, but one, I think, material point of clarification is on page five, second to last paragraph, second line, references existing stormwater. I think that's supposed to say storm sewer or stormwater sewer, however you want to say it. The others, as I said, I can just hand you if you'd like.
So can I have a motion to amend, to approve the amended minutes as amended by, stated by Commissioner Bauer?
So moved.
A second, please.
Second.
Can we take roll call?
Commissioner Biederstadt?
I'm going to abstain.
Commissioner Trussell?
Aye.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Aye.
Vice Chairman Bauer?
Aye.
Chairman Zeidel?
Aye. And the minutes are approved. Tonight we have a continued public hearing. This is PZC 2021-07, This is a public hearing regarding a request for approval of a special use permit for a private school with off-site parking facilities and associated variances located at 1736 Middleton Avenue. Director Smetana, if you could, well, first, I think I need to have a motion to reopen the continued public hearing.
So moved.
And a second, please?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And our hearing is now reopened. If we could start with an overview of where we are now compared to a month ago, Director Smetana, if you could give us that overview, please.
Yes, so this public hearing was opened at the September 15th Plan Zoning Commission. On that night, the primary focus of this commission and the public's discussion related to the applicant's request of for approval of a variance to increase maximum lot coverage on parcel two. This specific variance had previously been denied by both this commission and the village board. Since that meeting on September 15th, the applicant has formally withdrawn the request for approval of that variance for lot coverage on parcel two. So what's before the commission tonight for consideration is the special use permit and seven variances that were previously approved by the village board with amended conditions. The amended conditions allow the applicant some flexibility and requires the conditions to be completed prior to issuance of a certificate of occupancy. Whereas previous village approvals required the conditions to be met by specific dates. So Chairman, that's my high level overview. I'd be more than happy to answer any questions that the commission has.
At this time, I think I'd like the applicant to step forward and explanation of where we are, if you don't mind.
Good evening. My name is Keith Filipiak. I'm the superintendent of Lisle School District 202.
And Dr. Filipiak, you remain sworn in from the previous hearing.
Yes.
Thank you.
I believe the outline provided aligns exactly with our modified approach. The change was made in light of hearing the constituents at the last meeting give feedback as to what they wanted to see in the property. And so we made our best effort to make sure our application reflected what was requested of the people who live in that area.
Great. And have you reviewed the six conditions that the staff recommended in the staff report?
Yes.
And are you okay with them?
Yes.
Okay, great. At this time, I'd like to open it up to public comment. If anybody here would like to offer any comment on the application as it's been revised. And seeing none. Oh, wait, I have one. And I believe you gave comment last time, correct? Yes, so you remain sworn in. You can proceed. Go ahead.
Thank you. My question, is that legal for school district become the applicant for private school? That's my first question. The second question, is this special permit is transferable, can be transferred from school district to the private school?
Okay.
This is a two big issue.
Yeah, they're fair questions.
The village will get trouble in the lawsuit. Okay. The third one, last time, the civil engineer had mentioned twice the solution he provided not worse than. Remember, keyword is not worse than. That means maybe not improve at all. So I think this committee needs to consider it also about that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, and this fourth one, this committee already granted partial of the special permit for the school, can they reapply the, to modify some of your decision? That means everybody later can play the game. If I don't get approved last time, I can come back, reapply the, to modify what I don't have. This is not right. I think the only option they can be allowed is to change the timing, the schedule to complete the whole plan. But the whole plan should remain what committee had decided. Otherwise, you guys are smash your own face. You are going to announce we make a mistake last time. Okay, that's just my comment.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Before we move on, I'll ask Attorney Elliott to see if she could address some of those questions.
Sure. The school district is the property owner. Property owner always has standing to file a zoning application. Obviously, the conditions are going to apply to anyone who acquires any type of interest in the property. After that, they're still subject to all the terms and conditions because those conditions run with the land. You know, it's zoning applies to the property, not to who's owning or operating it. Everybody has to comply with what was approved. I would also comment that, again, you're not the final decision makers. You make a recommendation to the village board and they issue the final decision. With staff removing an automatic condition that everything is tied strictly to that property owner, that wouldn't be tied to that. And frankly, I don't recommend that condition. I don't really think that it's appropriate in every situation, only very specialized situations where it's very important who's operating the property. These conditions are pretty strict and would apply to whoever's operating the property at the time. But property owners always have standing to file an application.
Okay, so so for the point of clarity, the original ordinance from 2020 approved a special use permit for a private school for it specifically stated for it to be Kindy Academy. Does that mean if a different private school were to operate on this property that they would need an amended special use or a transfer of the special use?
Not if it's a private school.
Not if it's a private school.
Right. But with some other type of use, yes.
And if the attendance numbers or the occupancy population of students was different, would that trigger an amended special use or no? The number of students and
you know. I'll let Director Spintani answer, but I don't believe so. I mean, occupancy loads are controlled by the building code.
I think that the traffic impact reports and so forth that were submitted were all based on an occupancy lower than the building occupancy. Lower than what the building was historically used as a public school.
So if it was the commission's intent to ensure that the approvals were tied to findings, supporting documents submitted by the applicant, I would recommend that there be condition language to that effect. Otherwise, you know, 10 years down the road, the village is going to pull this ordinance. If the traffic analysis, if occupant loads are not specifically called out in that ordinance or referenced as an additional addendum to the ordinance, it's not going to be something that's addressed by staff. It'll be missed. So if there's concern about the number of students or traffic, there would need to be specific conditions calling those things out.
It's my recollection that the testimony from the hearings back in 2020 was for a maximum occupancy of around 180 students. And I don't know if anybody else remembers that, it being a number.
The applicant's findings of fact, page 38, state that Kinney Academy will have fewer staff and approximately 150 students, which is approximately 100 fewer students than Cape Woods Elementary School had in its last few school years. I mean, just weighing in on that topic, again, it's been...
It's been a while, I know.
Like more than a year, but my recollection is that there was a fair amount, and I'm not sure I can really characterize the word fair, but, you know, a few people at least who spoke specifically about traffic-related mm-hmm. concern, which for a private school like Kindy, where the pupils are being transported not by, you know, mass transit, i.e. school buses, but instead by private vehicles, that I think is a material concern, which to me makes important the granting of the special use based on, I guess, what I'll call a co-application from Kindy mm-hmm. Being quite relevant to an approval of that request.
So as the findings of fact say that it's an occupancy of 150, does everyone think that the condition of occupancy of 150 students is suitable to be added to this as a condition?
I guess I would look to the applicant and
ask if you're acceptable to that? Is it inconsistent with the findings?
I can't speak on behalf of Kindy specifically as to what they expect enrollment to be, but I would also, as mentioned earlier, it was over 100 more students there. I can't speak to how many people drove versus how many are on the bus previously when it was Tate Woods, and I can't speak to Kindy. Mm-hmm. But at this point, it sounds like they're feeling comfortable with 150, but I'm not sure they agreed to that would be the maximum they'd ever have in that school building.
And these are the findings that were submitted with the original application, right? Not the findings submitted with the second application.
Well, I have a little bit of a difficulty discerning what is part of the
real application.
Original package, including specifically the ordinance that granted approval, and what is instead part of the current request.
Current application. Director Smetana, can you help us with a little bit of clarity? Is the application that's in front of us today include findings of fact for 150 students?
Micah, the findings on page 35, are those current or?
They are, but there's findings of fact attached to the approved Village Board ordinance.
I think what starts on page 35 and runs through page 38 are the findings of fact attached to the original approval ordinance 2020-4872. I think that the findings of fact attached as pages 40 through 43 are supplemental from the applicant, but I need clarification.
While that's happening, does anyone else wish to give public comment on this? Please come on down. If you weren't here before, if you could state your name and be sworn in.
I'm Glenn Gretzmacher. I did swear
okay.
in.
You remain sworn in. Thank you.
Oh, my only comment is that, you know, we put up with the traffic, you know, the whole neighborhood that we live in, nobody moves out of. I mean, you have original people there for over 50, 60, 70 years that nobody moves. But it used to be the neighborhood school. You know, we didn't mind the traffic because we're taking our own kids to that school. Nobody's coming from different towns. Nobody's coming from, you know, different, you know, cars coming up. It's all gonna be cars. It's not gonna be any buses. And all I would have to do is talk to Sue, the crossing guard, and she could tell me exactly how many kids were on all the buses and who drove a car. She would know in a 10-minute talk with her. So that's the only comment that I have.
Thank you very much. Does anybody else have any comments? Please come on down.
Hello, Henry Shuffleack.
And were you here last time?
No, dear.
Okay, I need to swear you in. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes, I do.
Okay, please go ahead.
Since Glenn and I are neighbors, and Paul, we kind of experience the same things, but I can just tell you from my own past experience, and especially the past experience of my wife, we're one of the few houses in the neighborhood that the garage is set back very far. And it's also on my driveway is a 10% incline. Okay, so let's put it this, it drops, 10 feet from the driveway. But anyway, make a long story short, getting out of the driveway in the wintertime gets really, really difficult. In the morning, when parents of the students are coming by to pick up their kids, they're coming up that street at 30 to 40 miles an hour. Number one, because either little Ashley or Chad couldn't get themselves out of bed in the morning. You got two issues. The school buses parking on my side, which makes it difficult also to get out of my driveway because it's blocking my view to the south. But so in addition to the buses, the real criminals, as far as I'm concerned, it sounds like a powerful word, but it is people driving their own children at way over the speed limit. There's a sign posted, no or cell phone use prohibited. And believe me, somebody on the phone driving their kids at that speed up to the school. So the secondary issue as far as the traffic is, at the southeast corner, where you can exit the parking lot, there's a very large sign that says right turn prohibited. And it's constantly broken to the point that 2 years ago, I talked to the sergeant that was the traffic enforcement. And I said, look, these people are flying up the street to drop their kids off. I offered to let them park a radar car in my driveway. Well, one of my neighbors further north, their driveway is a lot flatter. They were writing tickets, one after another, not only for the speeding violation, because it's 20 miles an hour, right? But I mentioned the sign prohibiting right-hand turns. They wrote more tickets for people violating that. Okay, so there's an issue right there about the attitude of people coming up our side street, not their side street. So I thought it was awfully funny that the sign's right there and these people are making right-hand turns. So I got the buses. Now, if I understand this right, the students are gonna be coming in from suburbs far away from Lisle. So they're probably not gonna be bused, any number of them. And we might be able to get a count of how many are gonna be dropped off by mom and dad, or mom, dad, whatever, sister, which is gonna make that situation of people coming up the street a lot more intense. So I thought that there would be a little more concern. Next question is, my question is, one of my closest friends lives in Morton Grove, and two blocks away from the building that was purchased, you know, to create a school and essentially a meeting place. So the initial argument from the people that wanted to convert it into a school and a meeting place was that we'll have plenty of parking. You know, you'll never have an issue with parking in your own neighborhood. Well, the best word to use is that's an outright lie. My friend lives two blocks away from the school, and on whatever occasions for, let's say, some meeting service, cars all over the street, and that's a very quiet residential neighborhood. The street is Theobald, if you want to look it up. So, yes. Pardon me? Well, yes, that's a good example of lack of parking. I'm sure you're aware of... I'm sorry. All right. Yes. I could have brought that up, but Glenn did. Anyway, so with all of the promises that they were going to not have to, you know, have parking that wasn't available for when they have events, well, number one, there's one, it's a lie. And so my next question is, in other words, you give them an inch and they take a mile. And a lot of people are like that. A lot of people aren't. My next question is, since it's a secular school,
I don't believe that's accurate.
Pardon me?
I said I don't believe that's accurate. Is it? Is it secular or non-secular?
I'm not sure that matters with the zoning
okay.
issue.
I just want to make sure the statement is not
because I think it matters.
Incorrect, that's all.
I think it matters because if they're teaching Sharia, there's many, many things in Sharia. If you take a little time to read the Quran,
I'm going to have...
I
don't think that this is...
This is appropriate? Okay.
No, it's really not. And
so
thank you.
Glenn brought up village enforcement, which has been lax from the Bavarian Lodge. And the last question is, because it's considered a school, am I correct?
Private school.
Pardon me, dear?
It's considered a private school.
Will they fly an American flag? I'd like to know. Almost everybody.
I don't think the flying of a flag is a requirement in our zoning code.
Oh, I was just curious, okay? So anyway, the lack of accountability for the overflow parking, which really turns a nice quiet neighborhood, you know, into disaster, and the meeting overflow. And lastly, when I put my house up and my next door neighbor put their house up, and Glenn happens to live across the street from me, the enforcement on the codes were, I would say, absolutely correct in every possible way, and I was strictly held to it, and so was my neighbor. Glenn, I don't know if you had any problems with it. But now, what we just talked about, the lack of enforcement on parking, I had to replace the staircase in my garage because when, I think it was Tim Cassidy at the time, the height rise was 3/8 of an inch too high. So it's like another $1,800 to change the staircase. Tim also asked me to put a escapable window to meet the BOCA code so that in the first floor, or I should say the entryway, my late wife's hobby room, I had to have one that was to be used, you know, to escape. Though he said, you're not using this as a bedroom, but the person that's coming after you is going to. So if I get enforced on stuff like that, where I have to take care of it and comes, and that's a residence, just how good is the enforcement going to be on every, you got to tick off on every box? Or are you going to allow compromises, variances? That I would find very disturbing because I paid that out of my own pocket. And I had no argument with Tim. I knew exactly what he was talking about. He said, if I lose a firefighter because they're fighting a fire in your garage and they fall down your stairs and get trapped because the stairs are constructed wrong, he said, number one, it's going to be my rear end and the village's. And I understand it from that standpoint of making it safe while also taking care of the parking issue and everything else as far as the codes, the landscaping. I just hope it's going to be really, really enforced, because my neighbor next door to me also had the same issue with staircase leading outside from the second floor. So that's all I really would like to see is enforcement.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Is there anybody else who would like to comment? Okay, seeing yes, you would like to say something else. Yes, go ahead. If you could say your name again, it helps with the court reporter.
My question is, this time the application including extend last one, or this is restart over?
This is basically an amendment of an existing special use permit to...
Pardon me?
It's an amendment of an existing special use permit, now basically just changing the dates for the compliance.
So my opinion is only one option, just like a previous I mentioned. They can extend the completion time, not amend original yours decision.
I think that's exactly what's up for approval right now, is the original. And as you pointed out earlier, the only thing that's really different is the applicant, where the first time the applicant was the private school user, and now the applicant is the public school district owner of the building.
Then it's go back to original I mentioned. Can school district speak for the Kindy school? Because not offend. Mm-hmm. The school district just mentioned he cannot speak for Kindy.
Yes, I heard that too.
Okay, so this is several key point. Mm-hmm. Where this decision will be legal or not.
Yeah, I think your point is well made, and which is why I'm looking at the findings of fact that were submitted, because that does document the use in terms of things like occupancy, and that becomes part of the record. And in terms of transferring or amending the original one to the new one without the testimony of the user, the findings of fact will be what we would rely on.
I believe a committee will make a good decision.
We will try.
For our Lisle community.
Yes, and it's, again, a recommendation. It's not a decision. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there any other public comment? Seeing none, do any of the commissioners have any questions or comments?
Are we in fact, there's been several comments in regard to an extension. I do recall when we had our initial public hearing in 2020 that we did have some deadlines for the completion of various projects. I don't see those within the recommendation specifically.
Instead of recommending dates, we are requiring that those projects be complete before the village issues a certificate of occupancy. So in other words, Kindy Academy will not be able to occupy or use the building until those projects are completed.
Thank you.
Does anyone else have any questions, comments? If not, can I have a motion, please?
I have a couple comments.
Oh, okay.
So, with respect to staff recommended condition 4, I can appreciate in that instance and in all other proposed conditions the concept of tying the conditional modification or the conditionally required modification to the issuance of a certificate of occupancy. However, today, based on the public testimony we've heard, this impervious surface lot coverage issue on parcel two exists. So in my mind, while I hate to acknowledge it, because I don't want to be I don't want to throw a thorn into the side here, I'm questioning what is being accomplished. Is it equally acceptable for condition four to be addressed at time of occupancy as opposed to sooner, given that the condition, the site condition exists currently? Is there a greater imminency to address that site condition? I'm asking the question openly.
I think the imminency is tied to the use. If you can't use the property at all until it's fixed.
Agreed. What I'm saying, however, is if the property sits idle for another year or two or three, the impervious surface that currently exceeds what is permitted by code will continue to exceed what's permitted by code.
I hate to ask you to come back up. if I could have the applicant back up. Can you speak to the schedule a little bit for us of when we think the improvements would be made?
At this point, it'll all be contingent on the village. We're ready to go.
Okay.
Is the school district contemplating making the parking lot related improvement prior to sale of the property?
Yes.
Then that addresses my issue, my concern.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The other comment I have, which, you know, I've been vocal about in the past, and, you know, I'm equally, I guess, hesitant to do so, again, pertains to this south off-site parking field. I don't want to, you know, continue to beat the drum, but, you know, I feel like in fairness, we need to view this application like we would any private application, any private property owner application. And there are three things that, you know, continue to concern me about that offsite parking lot. One is the fact that section 5-4-3 regarding special uses in the R2 district does not specify an offsite parking facility as being unauthorized special use. Two is that section 5-2-3G, which pertains to nonconformities, states that if a use is discontinued or becomes inactive for a period of 12 consecutive months, any subsequent use of the property shall conform to the regulations of the applicable existing district. And three is that section 5-13-1-3A1, which pertains to location of parking spaces, states in all residential districts, parking facilities shall be located on the same lot or lots with the building they are required to serve. So in my mind, these are issues that need to be addressed, and they result in the same concern from me now that I expressed the last time, like 12 plus months ago when we heard this matter.
And does any of the other commissioners have any comments or questions? Okay, is anyone prepared to make a motion?
All right. Prior to issuing any motion, are we adopting any and all findings of fact and all submittals from the prior ordinance 2020-4872? I know there was some discussion in regard to what is going to be made of record, mm-hmm. and what is included, and if there's any additional conditions that are going to be put on. So I don't know if we want to have any discussion in that regard.
Well, the approval will definitely have to be subject to the findings of fact.
To clarify, the findings of fact submitted with this application starts on page 40 of the PDF. The findings of fact are on pages 35 through 39, are the previous case's findings of fact are appended to the village board ordinance.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but a motion to amend an existing special use, not to issue a new special use. That's correct, right?
Sure. I think it has the same effect.
Right. I mean, the findings of fact of the original one become part and parcel of what we're doing, or no?
Yes. I mean, the applicant copied.
Okay.
The original findings of fact and just resubmitted them.
They're the same.
It's the same.
So like, for example, the limitation on 150 kids is the same.
But I would ask that be a condition.
A condition.
I think, assuming that because it's in the findings of fact, that's going to be enforced down the road is a bad assumption.
I agree.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, I would say that you would want to adopt a condition that factual statements contained in the findings of fact shall be applied to the property, specifically occupancy statements in the findings of fact.
So an additional, and I mean, my notes here, basically an additional condition that would be that student enrollment not to exceed 150 students pursuant to the submitted findings of fact.
That would be great.
Okay.
I don't mean to interrupt, but unfortunately, Hatim from Kindy Academy had a family emergency. He was not able to make it. But it was my understanding that I wasn't present when this was initially discussed, but it's my recollection that Kindy Academy did not want to have that limitation. Do you recall, those of you that were here, that he was not comfortable with that limitation? And if you'd like for him to be part of this conversation, he said we can just give him a call on his cell phone, and he apologized for the medical condition that kept him here related to a family member.
Was this advertised as a remote meeting? I mean, do we have that capability?
No, it's a 100% in-person meeting tonight.
Right.
Does anywhere in the application it say that it would be limited to 150, because that's not the recollection of Kindy Academy?
Well, it's in the findings.
It's in the findings they submitted.
That it says you cannot have more.
No, but they submitted findings stating they intended to have 150 students.
They intend to have 150, right. But that's different than saying you can never have more than 150.
Right. Well, this will be going to the village board, so they will have the opportunity to.
Then I would ask that you vote on it tonight, and we will move forward. Thank you.
I think what we would do is just put the condition in to match the findings, because there's nothing else to rely on. And since there's no other testimony, we would rely on the findings.
And the findings say that there's an estimated enrollment of about 150. It doesn't request that there never be more than 150. I just want to be clear.
So the findings of fact says approximately 150.
Yes, it does.
I mean, that provides some.
Yeah. So like I said, my recollection is that, and I don't have it in front of me, my recollection is that the traffic study was done to 180. And I do recall that there was some back and forth discussion about the discrepancy.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but Hatim was comfortable with the 180, and that's what he recalls also. So I apologize.
Yeah. So, and obviously the issue with related to the occupancy being lower than it was as a public school goes directly to the traffic.
Yes.
Because the public school had a lot more students taking buses. And so the limitation on the use is the impact, for the queuing for the neighborhood. And without any other documents, we could only rely on what's already been submitted. So,
the traffic report estimated 180.
Nowhere
in the document mm-hmm. that it said.
And this says, and the findings say approximately 150, which obviously is what they're anticipating if in actual. The traffic study was 180. And then it basically says this is 100 fewer students than the Tate Woods Elementary School has had in the past few years. So obviously we don't want it to be 250. because there's no studies to support what would impact the neighbors would be at an occupancy of 250 students.
If you were looking for a proposal tonight to be able to vote on it, I would propose that you put the max at 180, and if for any reason something changes between now and the village voting on that, we make sure to make that clarification. But I do recall 180 being the max that Kindy was comfortable with, knowing currently they expect 150. Mm-hmm. And that's, as you pointed out, the traffic study reflected
was
the 180.
Correct. Okay. Again, I guess I'll try and ask if we can have a motion for all of this.
In terms of that additional condition, we would be restricting that to a maximum occupancy. We'll be conditioning that on a maximum occupancy of 180 students.
Mm-hmm.
Accordance with the traffic impact study mm-hmm. submitted by the applicant, or previously submitted by the applicant.
Excuse me, Commissioner. Commissioner Bauer, can you, just for my own sake here, really quick, can you please go back over the two points you brought up earlier, 5-2-whatever-G, and can you just state sure. that for me really quick?
There were actually three. If you want section references, I'll read them more slowly. 5-4-3. The next is 5-2-3G, G like girl, and 5-13-1-3A, like apple, 1. And do you want explanation?
I'm sorry, yeah, I'd actually like you to go back over your position on those again, please.
Sure. And I don't have the code in front of me, but I did look at it in advance of the meeting tonight, specifically because I continue to be troubled by these points. Just to state it as succinctly as I can, 5-4-3 pertains to special uses, and the uses that are specifically identified as authorized special uses in the R2 district in which this property is located. If you read that listing, there is no off-site parking facility or off-site parking lot or parking on a parcel or a lot other than the principal use, et cetera. So that's my first point. Second point is the section of the zoning code which pertains to nonconformities states that if a use is discontinued or becomes inactive for a period of 12 consecutive months, any subsequent use of the property shall conform to the regulations of the applicable zoning district. So I looked at that only because if, hypothetically speaking, the applicant took the position that, well, this is a legal nonconforming parking lot. It was approved previously by the village or by the regional superintendent of schools, whatever the case might be. If that was the case, I thought, well, we should be looking at whether it's legal nonconforming. And based on this provision that I just referenced, the fact that the parking lot has not been utilized for at least 12 consecutive months renders the parking lot subject to the now applicable zoning regulations. So it doesn't enjoy the benefit of a legal nonconforming status. The third point, which again is 5-13-1-3A1, is entitled locational parking spaces. It reads, and this is verbatim, in all residential districts, parking facilities shall be located on the same lot or lots with the building they are required to serve. I mean, we don't have a survey now, but I distinctly recall that this parking lot is a separate lot of record than the what I'll call building lot north of whatever that is, Middleton.
Thank you.
May I just quickly interject? The lot has been used a number of times over the last year. In fact, we had a very large fundraiser a few weeks ago that building was quite full. Hopefully you had a chance to attend the Homeschool Association's fundraisers, and that lot was full on a number of days. So if that is one of the concerns, that it hasn't been used as a parking lot in the last year, we would be able to provide documentation that it's been used a number of times in the last year. Thank you.
Director Montana, can you maybe provide me with a little.
So first of all, whether the lot was used or not is not relevant, because Lisle's zoning code amortizes all non-conforming uses. In this case, if you wanted to go down the road of stating that it was a legal non-conforming lot, it should have been brought into compliance by 1990, because our amortization took effect in 1987 and gave everyone 3 years to comply. So staff acknowledges all the points that Vice Chairman Bauer has made, and we've agreed with those points previously. We have a parking lot that was constructed at a time when school construction went through the state, not the village. Parking lot's been there. Staff's approach was to encompass the parking lot in the special use permit. That's why it's a special use permit for a private school with off-site parking, under the thought that this commission or the village board could at any time approve the special use permit for a private school and not include the off-site parking authorization as part of the special use. Now, Vice Chairman Bauer would state that while a text amendment could be performed, sure, I won't debate that fact.
Okay. If there's no other discussion, I'll again ask for a motion, please.
No further comments? In relation to PZC 2021-07, concerning the request for approval of a special use permit for a private school with off-site parking facilities and associated variances located at 1736 Middleton Avenue, I hereby move for approval of the following requests, subject to the finding of facts and any and all submittals provided by the applicant, contained within ordinance 2020-48-72, granted on June 15th, 2020, and any submittals and findings of fact contained within the current submission. Number one, special use permit to allow for a private school with associated off-site parking facilities. Number two, variance to allow for reduction to the required front yard setback from 35 feet to 22.56 feet on parcel one. Number three, variance to allow for a reduction to the required parking setback in the interior side yard from 10 feet to 0 feet on parcel one. Number four, variance to allow for a reduction to the required parking setback in the rear yard from 20 feet to 14.53 feet on parcel one. Number five, variance to allow for reduction to the required parking setback in the front yard from 35 feet to 0 feet in association with parcel two. Number six, variance to allow for parking for which no driveway permit has been issued to be located within the required front yard in association with parcel two. Number seven, variance to allow parking for which no driveway permit has been issued to be located within the required interior side yard, parcel one. Number eight, variance to allow for an increase in maximum lot coverage from 34% to 47.3% in association with parcel one. Said requests shall be subject to the following conditions. Number one, fencing. A 6-foot solid fence shall be constructed in compliance with Lisle zoning regulations along the south and west parking lot asphalt boundary of parcel two prior to the issuance of certificate of occupancy. Number two, site lighting. Parcel two shall comply with the Village of Lisle code with respect to regulations pertaining to site lighting prior to issuance of a certificate of occupancy. Number three, termination of a special use permit. The special use permit shall terminate and be of no further force and effect in the event that both parcel one and parcel two are no longer held in common ownership or the property is not utilized for the purpose of a private school with associated off-site parking facilities. Within 30 days of receipt of written request for proof of common ownership of parcel one and parcel two, the petitioner shall provide such documentation as may be required by the village attorney or village manager. Number four, parcel two lot coverage. Prior to the issuance of a certificate of occupancy, the petitioner shall make the necessary improvements in order to bring parcel 2 of the property into conformance with the requirements of section 5-4-5-A-5 of the Village of Lisle, Village Code pertaining to maximum lot coverage in the R2 zoning district. The petitioner shall apply for and secure a building permit from the Village of Lisle prior to any site development or grading activity on the property. Number 5, compliance with laws. The property and all improvements on the property will be used, operated, and maintained at all times in accordance with the applicable federal, state, county, and village statutes, codes, ordinance, rules, and regulations. Number 6, no authorization of work. This ordinance does not authorize commencement of any work on the property, except as otherwise specifically provided in writing in advance by the Development Services Director. No work of any kind may be commenced on the property pursuant to the approvals granted in this ordinance, unless and until all conditions of this ordinance precedent to the work have been fulfilled, and after all permits, approvals, and other authorizations for the work have been properly applied for, paid for, and granted in association with applicable law. Number 7, concerning occupancy, the occupancy shall be conditioned upon a maximum occupancy of 180 students based upon the prior submission of a traffic study.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
Do we as a commission believe that that contains everything that was discussed this evening and at the prior meeting?
I believe it does. The thing I guess I'm a little bit uneasy with here is that the co-applicant isn't here to, you know, we're kind of just pushing this over to the board, I guess. But it would have been, you know, for me personally, I guess I'm going to have to decide here relatively quickly. But because the co-applicant isn't here to say the 180 cap is workable, I mean, he may want it to be 200 and he could make the case for that. We have a traffic study, and if I recall right, the traffic study was riddled with all kinds of, in my estimation, issues, problems. You know, at one point they were arguing that it would be less traffic because of the buses, and I mean, it was just, I certainly recall that meeting, and that had a lot of issues for me. So the cap of the 180 students, I mean, can we even do this without the co-applicant here saying that that's okay?
I think we can rely on the submitted findings of fact, and if those...
Submitted findings of fact were 150, not 180?
But that includes the traffic study as documented here.
I do recall 180 back in 2020 being discussed.
I don't recall 180, but I do recall that we have an applicant's representative, i.e. the school district superintendent, telling us on behalf of contract purchaser that 180 is acceptable. So you know, that's obviously an applicant risk.
I also want to clarify that if there's any reason it would change, you know, they would have to bring that up at the village. It would just, you make your vote tonight based on 180 and we'll move forward, and it goes to the village based on your recommendation. If for some reason Kindy Academy wants to modify that, they would have to have that conversation, I would assume, directly with the village.
Yeah, I would honestly think that if they wanted a number over 180 and there was no supporting documentation and a traffic study, it would probably come back here with a revised traffic study to show the impacts of, you know, 200 or 225 or 250 or
whatever the requested number is.
Whatever the requested number is, because there's no supporting documentation for it to be more than 180. So I'm comfortable with it as a condition at 180, because I think the documentation exists.
Yeah, and then I also recall it also being at the 180 based on the traffic study. So yeah, I would be comfortable using the 180 mark as a limit.
Okay, is there any other
based upon my review of the meeting that occurred last month, do each of you as commissioners feel comfortable with the all of the water issues and everything that was being discussed at our last?
I hate to say it, but I don't, and this is the question I asked earlier tonight, with regard to condition four, parcel two lot coverage. I was asking earlier whether that condition should be a requirement to be completed, the installation be completed prior to the issuance of a C of O. Should it instead be within, you know, some date certain period of time? You know, like, for example, this ordinance 2020-4872 was approved, I think I saw June 15th somewhere. Yeah, June 15th. And condition four, or what was condition four, what would have been condition four, required that the lot two lot coverage improvements be completed by August 31st. So roughly 75 days. I'm not trying to create undue hardship here, but I hear the school district saying that the intention is for the school district to do this work immediately, not subject to sale of the property. And I hear certain property owners saying that they are immediately suffering stormwater management issues as a consequence of this parking lot, which, as I recall, the school district's engineer acknowledged was as a consequence of southerly sheet flow from the site. So to me, the most equitable thing to do, keeping in mind the school district's needs, keeping in mind the neighboring property owner's needs, is to require this condition four improvement or modification, whatever you want to call it, be done within some specified period of time, not merely on an open-ended basis, meaning prior to issuance of a C of O, which could be, you know, much longer than 75 days or 150 days or 6 months or whatever the case might be. It's you guys know how I feel otherwise, so it doesn't really matter, but that to me seems most equitable and most consistent with what was done previously and fitting for both the school district and the neighboring property owners.
Didn't mean to open Pandora's box there.
Oh, it's fine. It's fine. It's a fair point. I mean, an awful lot of time elapsed since the previous dates were put in and the work wasn't done. And I'm not sure why, but, you know, it's the same approval and the same scope of work that it needs to get fixed and brought into compliance. So there were deadlines before, they weren't met, which is why we're back here, because the deadlines were date certain. And so that required a full modification of the special use permit. So if we put a date in here and they miss it by one day, they're not in compliance. So I mean, I think part of it being done this way is so that if they do miss it by a day, they're not going through this whole entire process again. I mean, I think that's why it's being written this way.
And that's a fair point. And I'm not trying to complicate things. I'm just trying to balance neighborhood concerns with school district needs.
And correspondingly, maybe without it being a specified condition, I personally, not as a, you know, any authority, I would like to see some form of something set forth within the proposal when that's submitted to the village board to at least accommodate all of the neighboring properties so that they're well aware of when this is supposed to occur, so on and so forth. I'm not sure what needs to be done with staff and how you might go about getting the approval, but.
I guess, you know, I heard the applicant say they're ready to go. Right. So I would have absolutely no problem putting a date stamp on number four and saying that for the sake of the residents and the sake of moving this forward, I mean, I think that, you know, a reasonable time period given to comply with number four, I think that's reasonable on behalf of the residents.
Yeah, and then I would also agree with my fellow commissioners to also put some sort of date on there, whether it's 60 days or else 90 days to actually get the work done to make it fair to both the residents and then to the client.
So Director Smentana, has the school district already applied for permits for any of this work?
I'm gonna look before I answer that question.
I'm just wondering if the applications for the permits are.
So the scope of the work, we've already gotten approval for the fence. We have that in storage because there was a shortage on wood. I do believe we have the approval for the lighting. What we just need to do is work with staff in order to make sure that we comply with the 34% impervious pavement on that lot. And so we'll just have to work together along with what would be the new order to that owner. So when we cut a certain area out and dig everything out and replace it with grass, it complies with the 34%, so we only have to do the project once. We've already had a contractor out there in the last week measuring things for us. Okay. They're working together, putting a proposal. Our anticipated close date with Kindy Academy is April. And so we can get approval here and hopefully approval with the village in the next few weeks. Our intention is to close this April, but I would hope we could get this work done sooner rather than later to make sure that we don't impact the neighborhood more than it needs to be. So what we would do is work with staff in order to make sure that the 34% meets their measurement.
Okay, does anyone else have any other comments on this?
So Superintendent Filipiak, what does the school district believe is a reasonable period of time for it to have the ability to modify the parking lot to be in compliance with the maximum permitted impervious surface?
Because we're getting close to winter, I would hope that it would be in the next 2 months, but I would ask you give us until at least April 30th if that was reasonable, knowing how long the parking lot has been there. And that's in the anticipated close date. So it will be beyond the village vote at that point. We will finish the process with hopefully closing and be able to make sure that we can get our head around what those closing costs might include, knowing that we're going to have to do some of the work we've described tonight before we can close.
Okay, I appreciate that. I mean, it's obviously substantially longer than was initially contemplated when 2020-4872 was approved, but it is accomplishing the objective in my mind of establishing a date certain.
I would feel comfortable with a March 31st finish on this.
Ross, it was April, I believe.
Yeah, I understand.
Saying 1 month prior to closing.
Yeah, just to kind of put us in that category, spring has already hit. It's close to your date, but this way they can move forward with the sale and there's no, they can close on this and
staff,
be done.
In terms of balancing, obviously, the commission's request to have this done within a time certain, is there any complications that you may foresee? So that we can avoid having to go through the formal process all over again?
I guess time will tell.
Is there any possibility that we can...
Staff would...
simply make a recommendation rather than a formal condition?
No.
Is there any way to reduce the complication associated with this?
So if I can make a suggestion, could
the goal is obviously to get this fixed
for
the residents.
You could give me the authority to extend.
There you go. That's where I was going. Or any extension for the date would only require village board approval and not coming back. Like it's more like a minor change.
Or that.
That we do in a PUD.
You could do that.
Yeah. So you could come back and ask for an extension of the date without going through a planning and zoning process and notices and everything else. And an extension of the date would be straight to village board in a much simpler process that's kind of parallel to minor change to a PUD that we have in our current code because it is minor. Obviously, though, there's a significant interest in the neighborhood in having the work done. So that language being inserted into the ordinance that would allow that to a date beyond, let's say, the March 30th date would require an approval by the village board that doesn't require a full process, basically, with coming through this process for a hearing, if the ordinance could be written that way.
I think that's fine, provided that notice is...
With notice, but before the village board.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
No hearing, but still notice, because it affords the adjacent property owners the opportunity to...
say something.
Be notified of the fact that something might be transpiring and to, you know, weigh in to whatever reasonable extent we would want the neighbors to weigh in on any other matter. I feel like
and I guess I'll ask the village attorney if that's all feasible.
I mean, it's feasible. We don't generally send out notice on minor changes. So it's kind of setting a precedent of some substantial work on that. Maybe it would be better to say that the Director Smetana can grant up to a 60-day extension, and then there's some kind of time limit on it. You know, in case, you know, the ground's still frozen in March 30th or something.
That's fine from my perspective. I was just envisioning, you know, for some reason, something again transpires like COVID-19 and you know, then it's March 30th, 2022, and the request is, oh, we need until, you know, March of 2024. You know, obviously then we're exacerbating an existing ill.
I think, you know, the removal to make this compliant can be done quickly. Whether they put pavers in is not, because it accomplishes the same thing. So I think that the end of March is more than enough time to have that asphalt removed to become into compliance. I'm not worried about whether the pavers are put in there or not, or grass is planted. It doesn't matter to me. So I think we're overthinking this a little bit. We also had deadlines that weren't met before. We also have, you know, residents who are concerned with this. So, you know, I mean, you know, I wouldn't have a problem if this was not done in the next, you know, 60 days. You know, I mean, it's not hard to remove the asphalt. So, you know, whether the pavers go in or not is irrelevant to me.
All right, so
coming into compliance.
Is the intent of the commission to put a deadline on this or no?
Yes.
Yes.
Guys.
I think you know my thoughts. I think that that's the
deadline. So do you want to put it in there as March 30th and amend your motion?
I hereby amend my motion. You're not going to make me read the whole thing.
No, just the part that you're amending.
So just in relation to the condition number 4, parcel 2 lot coverage, I would amend that said recommendation that be on or before March 31st, 2022, and prior to the issuance of the certificate of occupancy at the beginning of that condition.
And a second on that, please.
Second.
All right, I'm going to call for roll call vote, please.
Commissioner Nakamura.
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell.
Aye.
Commissioner Biederstadt.
Aye.
Vice Chairman Bauer.
No, for the reasons I stated previously.
Chairman Zidell.
Aye. This application then moves forward with these recommendations to the next village board meeting. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, which I think is the beginning of November. Okay. Moving on to our agenda, skipping over the zoning code project, we'll move on to new business item B. Red Start Construction has filed an appeal of an administrative decision related to the interpretation of permitted uses in the B3A zoning district. If I could have a representative of Red Start Construction. And as he comes down, Director Smetana, if you could provide us with a general overview of your administrative decision, and we'll start that.
Sure. So Red Star Construction has expressed interest in relocating from their current location in downtown Naperville to 4742 Main Street here in downtown Lisle. 4742 Main Street is zoned B3A. Red Star Construction proposes to create a reception area, showroom, and meeting space on the ground floor for the purpose of facilitating walking customers and events at 4742 Main Street. In reviewing the zoning ordinance, staff, myself, has determined that the proposal most closely fits the business and professional office definition. And by definition, would require a special use permit to be located on the ground floor at 4742 Main Street. Now I will acknowledge that the showroom, the meeting design space, reception area, potential events is not necessarily consistent with a typical business or professional office. There are other uses that are undefined listed in the zoning code in the B3A district, including bath, bed, and kitchen shops and interior decorating stores that you could possibly argue the proposed use falls under. So to kind of facilitate a transparent, collaborative decision-making process for this use. Staff did encourage Red Star Construction to apply for this appeal. It is a free pass at this commission to see if perhaps my interpretation and classification of the use is not correct. That's my high-level summary. I'd be happy to answer questions, and I'm sure the applicant can further discuss his proposal for the site.
Okay, so let's hear from the applicant, and if you could state your name, please, and explain your side of the argument, if you would.
Sure. My name is Chad Meese. I'm the owner of Red Star Construction. The use on the ground floor and what we house within the facility are four designers, myself, and a receptionist. The use there really is an office use. It's more, we're a design build remodeling firm that basically does kitchens, baths, large additions. And the space would be used for meeting our clients, showing them their samples. It's an interior design space. This is exactly what the use would be for. You know, I think our name, Red Star Construction, kind of lends towards that. But if you look at our marketing material, it's Red Star Design, Build, Live. And like I said, we, you know, the primary use would be design consultation, interior design.
Do any of the commissioners have any questions?
In terms of that ground level, based on the packet, I got the impression that this was going to be a showroom, mm-hmm. that you'd have an example of all the different kitchens, bathrooms, different things that you guys offer, rather than a professional office space. Can you please speak to exactly what's going to be on that level?
Yeah, it would be a monitor, but also all of our samples. We stay away, and I think the industry's kind of stayed away from kiosks, because the industry and designs change so frequently that a lot of people have moved away from more of that showroom, but more of a virtual showroom. So, and clutter too. We keep all of our samples, whether it's cabinetry samples, tile samples, flooring samples, off the floor and bring them in for display for that meeting versus having them there constantly.
Off the floor, meaning off-site at an alternative location?
No, in this facility, there's a basement, there's a upper level space, something like that.
Not as part of the showroom is what you mean?
Correct. But there also is no office space in that ground level, meaning, you know, it's a more of a, like an island that you'd have in a kitchen that we use for conference, and then a monitor to go through we bring the samples out, but also visually bring up their plans, the design drawings for their space on the monitor.
Do you have a copy of the submittal package that you apparently provided to the village and the village in turn provided to us?
I don't, but I know it.
Okay,
so I don't have it with me, but
I'm wondering if you can just help me confirm that I'm reading the floor plan and the exhibits correctly in context. So off of what I guess is the main entrance to the right, which I presume is north, is some sort of like a side room with pocket glass doors. And I see in these computer generated interior room images some drawings that are labeled E6 with a apparently companion like computer generated desk image, E7, and then similar desk image. And then lastly, there's this what I think is also computer generated page of looks like the same meeting space from different angles. Is this those two desk spaces and this like table for like meetings, is that all in that room to the right?
The application is not specific to the space that's at this location. This was an example of what we would use the space for.
Are you sure about that? I'm asking because If this, is this the floor plan for the space that you intend to occupy?
No.
Oh, it's not?
No.
Okay, that's very helpful.
It was used as an example of what the floor plan would, you know, similar, but it's not specific. It is not that space. It's another space.
Okay, so what I was trying to get to is how much of the space will be utilized for office functions as opposed to like a showroom where you have a product that you can show a potential customer, hey, this is the kind of stuff that we do and this is what we can do for you, you know, to actually have someone see something tangible.
Yeah, 100%. There will be no office space except for our office manager receptionist that sits up front. So there's no permanent seat used as office within that first, the ground level.
What about like some sort of meeting space to like meet with prospective customers?
That would be, it would be used as a meeting space, yes.
The showroom would be used as a meeting space?
Yep.
So there's no designated conference room table, no designated desks?
We would have a second conference room somewhere else in that facility, but not on the ground floor. But we would hold meetings at that, on the ground floor.
Meetings with customers?
Yeah, to show them their samples and...
Okay, so I would view that as being more like a sales consultation.
Correct.
As opposed to a meeting.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. It's a design and sales consultation.
Okay, so my last question, I guess, is I think for staff, and that is, I don't recall what this use was called. In fact, I don't recall ever even seeing it come and go, but I do recall seeing a like kitchen renovation type establishment on the west side of Main, sort of down by like where the shoe store was, you know, down kind of closer to like the Fox restaurant. Do you know what I'm speaking of?
Others have referenced that store. That predates me, so I'm not aware of it.
Okay.
That's
because my question ultimately was going to be, how did that type of use get established there? Because that, in my mind, from recollection alone, seems to be a lot like what this contemplated use consists of.
And I wasn't aware of that use.
Okay. Does anybody else up here recall that use? No,
no, I don't.
Okay.
So you said that there might be other offices. Would that be like on the lower level?
Yep.
Okay.
So there's three levels within there.
Mm-hmm.
So there, that
the
would
office
be,
spaces.
That would be used for office space. The basement would be used for file storage and sample storage.
Okay. Anybody else have any questions? So at this point, because this is an actual formal appeal, this is one of those times where the Planning and Zoning Commission does more than make a recommendation. We make a decision of whether or not we agree with the staff recommendation or we don't. So at this point, I guess I'd ask for someone to make a motion of whether or not.
A little discussion, maybe?
Yeah, before we do that, can I have one more moment to discuss this with the applicant? So ultimately, the decision that's before us is the B3 district is to accommodate pedestrian-oriented development. So effectively, will the public at large be able to just come into your shop and be able to look at any product, shop for anything? Would it be inviting pedestrian traffic to your business?
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, even talking to other store owners along Main Street there, you know, we'd love to do events with them. There's already kind of a household, you know, I don't want to call it trinkets, but that type of stuff. We'd love to partner with them, have them in. Invite them to work with our customers as well for additional improvements within their home. You know, we do that now just to invite people in and see what we do and sell them on our product, which is kitchens, baths, and improvements to their home.
Because that's really the decision that we have to make.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I guess, you know, I'm having business and professional office. I mean, this really is a consumer service business. That's what you are.
It right? is. I mean, we're working within the residents of the community. That's our job. So, yeah, it's a little different than.
But that squarely puts you in a business and professional office category.
So in our code right now, we don't actually have a category called showroom, do we?
No.
No. That's kind of part of the problem. So we have the ground floor business or professional office, and then we go straight to something being basically a shop or a store. And there's really nothing in between that's a showroom from which I custom order something, basically. And you sell it, but you're not selling it directly off the floor. You're selling a product, but it's all basically custom ordered.
Design?
Design. And I'm assuming you're selling product.
Yeah, we are. But off the floor or out of there or walk
in? No, not out of the front door, right? It's
design,
everything is
design we would sell out the front door, but there isn't a physical, you know, vase
so,
or...
So are you selling the product or are you ordering the product and it's being shipped from a manufacturer? You never take possession of the product, correct?
Correct.
So you're not really selling any products. You're accommodating the ordering of a product.
Right.
Okay. I just
besides
think that's
our design.
Mm-hmm. So it's not really a showroom then? I mean, it's... Yeah.
I would say that it's
a showroom would be to sell a product.
Yeah, but in our industry,
the product is the design work.
And any remodeling showroom, kitchen and bath showroom, is in the exact same situation. Mm-hmm. They're not fabricating it in the basement and letting you walk away with a vanity. It's the same thing. Well, any
no, you're not buying inventory, possessing it, and then selling it, taxing it, and.
Yeah, I mean, you could say the same thing in the automotive industry right now. You go in to buy a part for your car, they're not, it's not there. They're ordering it in.
AutoZone has them.
What's the point of sale? When I come into your establishment and I say, I want to, you know, hire you to do design services for my kitchen remodel, and you say, okay, great, and you draw me this fantastic plan, and you show me these cabinets, and I pick out the color and the face paneling and all that stuff, and I order the cabinets through you. Is the point of sale your establishment, or is the point of sale the vendor that you use to supply the cabinets?
No, the point of sale is in our office.
Okay. See, that to me...
That's a store.
Yeah, that to me seems
not
like...
Only, I mean, with COVID, we did virtual sales, you know, but typically our process is that we sell a design agreement to them, and then we sell a construction contract to build it. And all of those design agreements, we bring them into our showroom, review the scope of what they want to do and what we're providing, and we go through it there at that facility. And then we sign the agreement and move forward.
So again, if I'm the customer, I'm contracting with you to supply me design services and materials, i.e. cabinetry.
Yep.
And so my $100,000 remodeling bill is paid to Red Start Construction.
Correct.
And it's materials and labor.
Yep.
And the materials portion of that is your sales tax revenue generating downtown business.
To me, that seems identical to or akin to at least an interior decorating store, which I recognize staff is saying is an undefined term, but it is a permitted use on the ground floor of the B3A district.
Director Smentana, does that sound correct? The flow of here, the sales tax they're selling. I mean, is that your understanding as well?
I would pose the question to the applicant: are you paying sales tax at your current location?
Not for for cabinets, yes, and not on every instance.
Why not?
Depends on if we have a direct relation or if we have to go through a broker. If we go through a broker, they pay the sales tax. We don't. So if we're buying it straight from the manufacturer, then we pay the sales tax. If we buy through a broker that brokers different cabinet lines, then they pay the sales tax.
Complicated.
It's a complicated business.
And any consumer
can say
that they have their own cabinets and they want to get them themselves, correct? So again, I just kind of go back to this is a consumer service business. This is not a standard brick and mortar, walk in, I sell you something business. This is a service business.
The first half of our business is interior design. We're no different than any other interior design company that's out there. They don't pay sales tax.
Yeah, so maybe I'll try and ask this question a little differently. In terms of the revenue that you generate for your business, is it predominantly the design fee or is it predominantly the sale of product? Material, labor, what's the primary source of revenue?
The sale of the material, labor, putting the product in place.
The taxable portion of the business, like the product part, like as opposed to the services part, like i.e. a store.
That's where the majority of our revenue comes from building.
Okay, but the building includes materials and labor, so I'm asking right. just about the materials part.
Yeah.
The percentage of the business that's related to the sale of material.
Yes.
Is the predominant part of your business, i.e. more than 50%?
Yes. Probably 80%.
Okay.
I'm sorry, to be clear, you're saying that of the services you provide, approximately 80% is typically assignable or allocable to materials, not to services, not to labor or design?
No. Sorry. I thought you were talking about lumping material labor.
No, I'm talking about
just the materials.
I'm talking about just the sale of some kind of a product.
It's below 50% because it's the product that we're putting in place. So of our total revenue, no, materials are
less than half of your business.
Yep.
So what is your argument for how you are, I mean, I know the obvious answer, but what's your argument for how you are distinguishable, for example, from the service provided by an architectural firm? And I ask that because the definition of business and professional office specifies, as an example, an architectural firm.
For what we're using this facility for?
Correct.
There is no difference. I mean, we are producing architectural permit-ready set of plans to be submitted to whatever village we're working in.
So you're saying there is no difference between the type of service that you provide in an architectural firm?
Or an interior design firm at that location.
Okay, so if that's the case, then you're acknowledging that you need a special use permit at this location.
Yeah. I thought we agreed that an interior design showroom is allowable.
An interior decorating store is allowable, which, by the way, is an undefined term according to the staff report, but the definition of business and professional office, which is required to be established only after approval of a special use permit, that definition includes architectural firms.
I assume your designers are architects, correct?
They're not licensed architects. They're licensed designers, interior designers. So if we need an architectural stamp, we don't have an architect on staff. Again, we're interior designers. If we need an architectural stamp, we outsource that.
Let me ask you one more question.
Sure.
I'm just curious, how much time did you wait between, you know, when you advised staff that you wanted to make this request for an appeal until tonight's meeting?
It was Friday.
Oh, okay.
Last Friday.
I was going to ask you if there's any particular reason that you didn't just want to request a special use permit.
Because we're trying to purchase the building. It's not just occupying the building. So.
But is there a particular time sensitivity? Like, you know, are you trying to purchase it in like less than 30 days?
Yeah, I mean, we would try to close within 60 days.
Okay, well, just so you understand, I'm asking you these questions because you know, you do have a path, an option, you know, assuming that the Planning and Zoning Commission determines that staff was correct in its interpretation, your option would be to seek a special use permit because that's what the zoning code allows or you know, mandates for a business and professional office use. I'm telling you that for your benefit so that you understand what avenues you have available.
Sure.
Is there any other discussion or questions?
And just for the applicant's own edification, so all of these questions that we've been firing at you, effectively, we have a decision to make and we're bound by the code as it stands at this time. So in terms of what we have to decide upon, it states the B3 district is to accommodate pedestrian-oriented development in the downtown area, consisting primarily of retail service, specialty shops, and a mixture of pedestrian-oriented uses, including retail service, office, residential, and public use. Now, in terms of that ground level, if you fall within the business and professional office, then we are not permitted to grant that. But if you fell within an undefined definition of bath, bed, and kitchen shop and interior decorating store, then we could have moved forward. I don't know if you'd like to speak to any services you're offering any further, but.
If I came here and my company's name was Red Start Kitchen and Bath, would there even be a question? Because it's, I'm sorry to laugh. It's just kind of, there, you know, all my, it's just, a, it's a, at that point, it's almost a name.
It's not about the name, though. It's about the service provided.
But we provide the same service as any company that does kitchen and bath. That's what we do. So, I guess.
Well, I mean, I'm just playing devil's advocate here.
Sure.
Just for the sake of having a complete discussion.
Uh-huh.
Again, the use category of what the zoning code calls bath, bed, and kitchen shop,
mm-hmm.
to me, based on what this district is intended to accommodate, would be something like the Bed Bath & Beyond store that we know, where there's goods being sold of that nature, bath, bed, and kitchen shop. That said, I can make some arguments, or at least I think one colorable argument about why, your type of use is distinguishable from like an architectural firm. I guess my point is that, I'm not sure that there's such a material distinction between whether something is, purchased out of inventory on hand in an establishment mm-hmm. by way of being special order. I mean, in the end, there's still a purchase being made of a tangible good.
Right.
I guess there's no threshold on a percentage basis as to, what amount needs to be the good versus the service. And obviously this is, according to at least to what we're being told by the petitioner, this has some level of a good or mm-hmm. What the law would call chattel being transferred by comparison, for example, to the realty office.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
By the way, these are arguments you're supposed to be making.
Yeah, the problem here is.
Well,
that
I appreciate that. I mean, you're. If I walk down there, there's probably a lot of places that exist right now that don't meet exactly the real estate office being the main one.
Yeah, I think they went through and got a special use permit, though.
I know they did. I recall it.
Yeah. So, I mean, there is, like he said, there is an avenue for all these businesses. I mean, the hair salons as well, they all have to get a special use permit under the current code the way it's written. And we don't have the ability to change the code. When we evaluate the appeal, it's the code the way it's written. And then all we're doing is making an interpretation. Does anybody else have anything they'd like to say? Or make a motion to either uphold the village staff's determination that the proposed use is a ground floor business professional office, or to reverse the village's staff's determination and to classify the proposed use as a shop or a store. Unfortunately, I don't think there's anything in between those two uses, but that's kind of what we really have, is something that's a little bit of each.
Well, one thing that I'll say for, I guess, consideration by all is if you look at the types of uses identified in the definition of business and professional office, which I'm again reading before I speak further, in not one of those instances can I think of a situation, perhaps with the exception of architectural firm, where you can either purchase on site or, you know, via special order, some type of a good, mm-hmm. which is distinguishable from this based on the representation from the petitioner that there is some level of goods being sold.
And correspondingly, I kind of envision that what's defined here, you would never envision somebody walking up the street and happen to just venture into haphazardly. Whereas, I believe there's some form of a showroom.
All right, people gotta make up their mind now. I need a motion. Too much ruminating. Let's go. This isn't that hard. All right, I don't think I can make the motion. Guys, come on.
Village attorney, does it matter if the motion's made in the affirmative or the negative?
That's why I was hesitating as well.
Well, on the,
I would pick one or two. I would pick one or two.
Yeah, the staff report number one and number two.
Oh, I somehow was overlooking.
It's either a motion to uphold or a motion to reverse.
I'll make a motion to reverse village staff's determination and order village staff to classify Red Star Construction's proposed use at 4742 Main Street as a bath, bed, and kitchen shop or interior decorating store, both of which would be permitted uses in the B3A zoning district.
Can I have a second, please?
Second.
Any other further discussion? Roll call.
Commissioner Nakamura.
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell.
No.
Commissioner Biederstadt.
Aye.
Vice Chairman Bauer.
Aye.
Chairman Zeidel.
Aye. And the commission has determined that the commission will reverse the staff's determination and reclassify the proposed use as a shop or a store. And that decision is final.
Thank you. Which means you can locate that. Yeah, thanks. I appreciate it.
Okay. Moving on our agenda. Does anyone need a break or anything? We good?
I could use a glass of water, but if you can tolerate me getting up for 15 seconds, I'm
okay.
Fine.
I'll tolerate you for getting up for 15 seconds while I read the intro here. Next up on our agenda is a development concept proposal for a Jimmy John's with a drive-through located at 5515 Main Street. I'd ask staff to provide us with an overview to open this up, except staff took a little break.
Yeah, he went to get some water.
All right, well, let's just wait. If anybody else wants water, okay?
Chairman Zeidel, are you waiting on me?
I am waiting on you. Okay. Could you give us an overview of the development proposal for Jimmy John's, please?
Yes. So JS Fort Group Incorporated has requested the opportunity to provide a development concept proposal to this commission. Now, I will note that an application has been submitted to village staff, and that application is under review with the goal of having public hearings conducted by this body in November. The application will be for a drive-through for a proposed Jimmy John's. That Jimmy John's and drive-through would encompass one half of the building that was formerly Granny's on Main Street. There would be another half of the building that would be made available for a future commercial tenant lease. So staff has provided as part of this development concept proposal more or less all the documents that have been submitted as part of their formal special use permit application. So you have the zoning application, photometric plan, site plan, plat of survey, traffic analysis, and landscape plan. And the applicant is present tonight to give a brief presentation to this commission. Again, the purpose of these development concept proposals is to provide the applicant with valuable feedback as they move forward through the entitlement process.
Terrific. Can we have the applicant come forward, please? So this is a sort of an informal process. The commission doesn't make any decisions or recommendations, just some general feedback. And then there would be an actual public hearing. And after the public has a chance to weigh in, then the commission makes recommendations.
Sure.
So if you could just state your name and give us an introduction of what you'd like to do. Thanks.
Cody Whipple, real estate manager of JS Fort Group, Inc. The reason I did want to get in here before my hearing date, targeted hearing date next month, is because we will have to close on this building before then. At least that's a targeted closing. We will try to ask for more time, but I'm doubtful of getting that. That being said, we are in escrow on this building. But Michael over here explained it pretty well. That is what we propose to do. This building is about 2,500 square feet with intentions of occupying half of the space and leasing up the other half. I would say closing is contingent on getting that drive-through permit. I don't think the value is there for us as a company if we cannot achieve that. So my purpose of this meeting is to really just get everybody's feedback to help me gauge on the feasibility of being granted that special use permit. Based off of initial conversations with Michael, I am confident about it, but I would just want to get more assurance within this meeting.
Okay, I just have a couple quick things on the application. You know, when you guys filled this out, Michael, who fills out the information on the application?
The applicant.
Okay. Current previous use of the property was not fast food. So this, I would not categorize a breakfast restaurant as fast food. I also want to ask you quickly, no, you're not going to be doing anything with more outdoor lighting with drive-through. You're not adding lights to the outside perimeter.
So we are in the process of getting elevations and a signage package. And also, I don't think I have sent you the lighting package. Okay. As well.
So you would be you're going to require new outdoor lighting, correct? So that would be a yes, not
for the
no.
Drive-through, correct?
Okay. Signage, I was briefly looking at. I think that's a reasonable request. It's just my personal opinion on that. I do have a question about your average trips. You're saying that you're going to have an estimated daily vehicle trips of 75. That means you're overall in the fast food business, your restaurant would only have 124 check averages per day. Is that consistent with what your Jimmy John's do, 124?
So this would be a relocation from our store in Woodridge, mm-hmm. which is actually just located mile and a half south on Main Street. And that's very similar to those numbers. And we would expect similar numbers.
So does that current one have a drive-through?
It does not.
So given the industry standard that a drive-through would generate roughly around 60-65% of business, I would estimate your trip average is probably off by quite a bit. I mean, which is why you probably want a drive-through, correct? So I would just recommend that you maybe take a look at that number and give a reasonable number so that if a traffic study, for instance, for myself, I probably would want to see some kind of a traffic. You're not at a stoplight, you're not at a stop sign. People going left out of that property. You're very close to the intersection. would probably want to have a little bit of a look on how that would impact traffic. I believe the Maple and 53 corner generates around, and this is probably a couple years old, around 60,000 vehicles a day. And then on the north-south on Main Street or 53, you're a little over 30-some thousand people a day traveling by that location today. So it's a great location. But I would probably say that that would, you know, I would probably take a look at that number and maybe give it a little bit more thought to do that.
We do have a traffic study. I'm not sure what that says pertaining to your question, but that is done on our end.
Okay. All right. Very good. So, yeah, so I just think that that number that you're representing on your application is a little bit, we'll just say low. I mean, obviously, yes, if it didn't have a drive-through, I would probably say your number's probably accurate, but with the drive-through, I think that would go up.
I just have a question as to what your intention is with the rest of the building. What sort of tenant are you planning to have that would share your use of the front of the building?
We don't have a tenant in place right now, so we would put it on the market. I have my real estate broker sitting over there, and he would be helping me with that. I would say we do not want another restaurant, so it would most likely be retail or office.
Okay. They would share the same parking lot and all that traffic going on through there?
They would.
Director Spintana, did you, I don't know if this even got to this point, I mean, from a parking requirement, maybe advise on?
So what I can share with the commission, and this is, you know, relatively new, certainly after the commission's packet was prepared, the traffic analysis that was submitted in proposed site plan has been provided to the village engineer to review. The village engineer has a PTOE on staff. And they will review the traffic analysis and drive-through submitted and ask for modification similar to the process that we did with Schmaltz. I have completed a zoning review of the proposed site plan, landscape plan, and have identified 17 variances that are required in addition to the special use permit. Now part of the reason for that many variances is the way the current zoning code is constructed, and that they have to comply with all of the code requirements. so there's really no leniency or forgiveness for an existing site. So as it stands right now, a special use permit and 17 variances.
What would that change to under the new code?
There's no guarantees that the new code is
there would be fewer variances because the new code has very specific parameters as to when you have to comply with certain things. So for instance, with landscaping, landscaping is only required if you expand a parking lot.
Mm-hmm. As opposed
where
to
right
reconfigure
now you have
it.
To just meet the current landscape code as if the site's being developed today. Mm-hmm. Staff's direction to the applicant today, he may not have even read this yet, was to reduce the number of variances as much as possible.
And you've reviewed all those variances with the applicant, like what
the
they are?
The review letter was sent at about 5:30 today.
Oh,
so
okay.
I received
perhaps
it.
Perhaps he's read it.
I wouldn't
maybe
say.
He hasn't, but.
Yeah, I've received it.
Okay, so we briefly talked about the fact that you're doing a traffic study, the village is reviewing the traffic study, and I'm assuming this it deals with the queuing issue.
That's correct.
Right, and our engineers will review it, have not done so yet.
Correct.
Okay. We talked briefly, I heard landscaping. Is there a landscaping plan that is submitted?
There is.
There is one?
The last attachment to this,
by the way,
staff report.
By the way, for the applicant.
Oh, there we go. Sorry.
Just take a close look at your site plan and your landscape plan and make sure they're consistent. You know, mm-hmm. for example, I see discrepancy in parking counts in one plan versus the other.
Thank you.
And by the way, before we get too far away from the point, and I'm sorry, I don't know if you were going to speak. Two other things. One, with respect to variations or the number of variations, I think that you would do well to heed staff's advice, recognizing, of course, that it is an existing development and that you're attempting to retrofit it for your proposed use. Mm-hmm. But, you know, be prepared, you know, come with your experts able to address the relevant standards of review for in support of your request for why we should grant your variation requests. And then also, you know, make sure that your traffic study or anything you submit is, you know, reflective of this site. It looks like there's a carryover in note one on the third page of the report, which is apparently from, you know, prior report. It's referencing Roosevelt Road, which obviously is not relevant to this site. So the last comment I have is, I guess, one for maybe the concept applicant's thought and equally for feedback from my peers up here. And that is, does anybody have any type of, I guess, concern or trepidation? I was trying to, I don't frequently visit QSR restaurants, but is there any type of concern associated with the, like, stacking, drive-through stacking of vehicles adjacent to the angled parking stalls, mm-hmm. in terms of their ability to, you know, egress back out of those sites and be able to
drive I think there away. Should be adequate aisle width, right? So being able to pull out and having adequate space between the queuing line and the end of the parking spaces. So it does look, at first glance, because I can't tell what the dimensions are, but it does look at first glance that it's tight. I mean, I can see that there's an intent to restripe the lot to increase the angle of the parking, obviously to reduce the depth. So the aisle width, obviously, correct me if I'm wrong, but this would also go and get reviewed by, like, the fire department for emergency vehicle access, and there has to be adequate aisle width, right?
So we, the village certainly,
you sigh.
The village certainly involves the fire district on new developments.
Oh, and you're not going to classify this as new?
Correct.
Okay.
Do any of the variations that you referenced earlier include stall depth or drive aisle width variations?
No, they comply with the zoning code requirements. Now,
okay.
What the zoning code does not contemplate is a drive-through stacking lane, sharing the aisle with parking. I mean, it just doesn't contemplate that. But in terms of the parking stall dimensional sizes and the required aisle width associated with that parking stall, the site complies.
Okay.
Wait, so there's no minimum required width for a parking, or excuse me, a drive-through aisle?
There's no design guidelines in the current zoning code for drive-throughs.
But there is a minimum required width for a parking lot lane, drive-through lane.
Correct.
Is that 24 feet?
No, it depends on the angle of the parking space. So it varies.
Okay, well, I don't necessarily need to know it. It sounds like you looked at it.
Yeah, it's exactly.
For a 45-degree parking stall, which is what they're proposing, the aisle width only has to be 14 feet per our code. And they're at, I think this site plan shows 19 between the building and.
And that can be shared with the drive-thru?
Code doesn't say it can't be.
Is the parking lot drive aisle width reduced if the parking is like 60 degrees instead of 45?
That's tight.
So for a 60 degree parking stall, the associated aisle width is 18 feet. For a 30 degree, it's 12 feet. So it's.
So I mean, that's something I would look at if I were you. Mm-hmm. You know, do you need the parking supply that you currently have depicted on your proposed site plan? If not, can you
eliminate some stalls or maybe reconfigure some stalls perhaps in the southeasterly or northeasterly portions of the site to, you know, maybe not lose so many, but in the end, you know, still meet the necessary parking demand that you anticipate both for the Jimmy John's and the unidentified retail space, retail user, and at the same time, you know, provide a reasonable drive aisle width for cars to be able to get in and out of those spaces, however they're angled, 45, 60, 30, whatever degrees, without being in conflict with stacking for the drive aisle.
Yeah. And what I will say to that is that if you look at it, and once you guys read the traffic study, on the other side at any given time, there won't be more than 2 to 3 cars, which will only affect 4 of the parking spaces on the north side. And what our plan would be is to have those just be parking spaces for our employees. So those won't be spaces where people are going in and out all the time.
Okay, and I will say this. I mean, I've been through a Jimmy John's drive-through, and they are extremely quick. So I do believe that you're stacking. I believe that that could probably be true there. I would just say, you know, when you officially go forward with this, I would probably want to look at emergency access between the south side of the building if there's cars in those parking spots and there's cars lined up in queue, whether or not an emergency vehicle can get through that. I imagine somebody would look at that. Is that correct, Director?
Yes.
Okay. So I think that that would be good. The only other comment I have, and I have two more comments, and I don't know if they're, you know, if I officially can even make this. One would be to rent out that retail space over there when you have a drive-through lane right outside their door and your employees are parking in those slots. Good luck renting out that retail space. I think it might be more difficult, prove a little bit difficult there. I don't know that the combination of businesses, you know, how that would impact. I think it would depend on the kind of business that goes in there. And I don't know how much that would impact an approval or a recommendation on this side, but I think probably some guidance when you come back of saying this is kind of what we're looking for, this type of a business to go in there and maybe be a little bit more firmed up in what your plan is for that other retail space would probably be a positive thing. And then the restaurant program grant request of $50,000 for a I don't know where that, I know, I'm pretty sure we don't have any weighing on that, but you're leasing out half the property. So I guess I'm a little confused on seeking that aspect of it as well. But short of that, I think, you know, it would be a welcome business in Lisle, I'll say that.
Great, thank you.
Just really briefly, there's no residential around the perimeter of this property, correct?
Correct.
Okay, and while I don't think this affects you, I think it's important to point out the draft rewrite of the zoning code would treat this application somewhat differently than the current code, correct?
It's correct. A special use permit would not be required for the drive-through.
Right, and all of this material would basically just go through staff through a normal approval process.
Correct.
Okay. Just wanted to point that out. Of course, we're in the process of rewriting our zoning code. Obviously, it's not going to fit your time frame. Mm-hmm. You know, the revisions would make a project like this much more streamlined, where you wouldn't have to come through this board, nor would you have to go through the village board. It would just be a use that would be allowed, you know, subject to meeting the rest of the village code requirements. So if you still needed variances for various little items, you'd still have to come, but otherwise the drive-through portion of it wouldn't require a special use permit. I mean, overall, I think the application seems very complete. Your intent seems very complete. It's very analogous to the Schmaltz application, I think. And the request is reasonable, and I don't know that there would be any different treatment of it than how we handled the Schmaltz application. There are suitable conditions on the special use that you probably could expect that there would be some, and I'm sure staff will go through them with you. And in terms of like the volume of variances, I'm sure the staff will guide you along the way to which ones would be more suitable to try to eliminate. And working with Director Smetana will get you there the fastest way possible.
Great, I appreciate that. One thing I would just want to ask real quick is, Michael, I know you just sent me that third review 4 hours ago, but can you recall any large variances that you would want us to deduct that we can tackle right now that I have my engineer here? Or should we save that for?
I don't know that this is the format for that.
Okay.
But we can certainly have a conversation tomorrow.
Understood.
Yeah, I think if you and your professionals work with staff, it'll put you in the best possible position to get through this process as quickly as possible.
Understood. Thank you all.
I hope that was helpful.
It was helpful.
Okay, good.
Appreciate it.
Thanks. Bye. Now, are we ready to move on to the big one? Okay. Moving on our agenda. So BPZC 2020-14, comprehensive amendment to Title V of the Lisle Village Code zoning regulations. This public hearing was closed at our last meeting. And at this point, this is the, commission's time to discuss and review the final, I think, draft of the code and make a recommendation of whether or not we would approve this version or further yet amend this version and forward any other recommendations accompanying it to the Village Board for their consideration. We went through the changes at the last meeting, so I guess I'll go straight to board discussion. If there's anything that anyone would like, and then overall, instead of going through it chapter by chapter, if there's anything you'd like to just jump right in and get to, rather than going through it section by section.
I have one thing out of the gate that I think can be quickly and easily discussed in the last concept review. I'm sorry. I began to say that I have one thing out of the gate that I think can be quickly and easily discussed, and that the concept review discussion we just had is probably as good of a transition as any into this. But, you know, given the duration that we've been, period of time that we've been discussing this amendment, I'm struggling to recall the rationale employed with respect to drive-through facilities and not requiring them to be special uses. So I'm wondering if perhaps Director Smetana can refresh my recollection as to, you know, the discussion and the ultimate determination made. I think I can generally recall it.
So I don't know that we certainly identified the fact that the draft ordinance proposed allowing it. I don't know that we spent a whole lot of time discussing that proposal. Essentially what staff set forward for discussion was allowing drive-throughs as a permitted use, but having specific design standards that the drive-through has to meet.
That's exactly what I thought.
Whereas right now, a drive-through is a special use permit and there are zero design standards.
Okay, so I'm looking at the code now, page 163, and the rationale ultimately is that those design standards will ensure that the drive-through facility is adequately designed to avoid any type of vehicular conflict or other type of concern. And for that reason, there's no need to require an additional layer of approval being a special use permit?
That's correct. I mean, staff's general assumption, I guess research finds that virtually every drive-through request gets approved by the village. So why keep bringing something forward, requiring applicants to go through that process if we know what the end result will most likely be?
And so long as they can be adequately designed to avoid
correct
the concerns.
Correct.
So this is ultimately just sort of with an eye toward the overall intention of being, of streamlining the process and being more accommodating to applicant requests within the reasonable bounds of what the village can do to ensure no detrimental impact to adjacent properties?
Correct.
Great, thank you.
So it's my understanding that if a drive-through use is under the new code, the drive-through use is 50 feet essentially from a residential district, then it puts it in a category of variance or a special use?
I'm double checking right now. I believe it's a variance because
variance,
they don't meet a numerical standard.
Right. So the way it's written here is basically the speakers have to be 50 feet away. The menu boards have to be 50 feet away, or the menu board signage has to be 50 feet away. So essentially that means the drive-through itself is 50 feet away. So in the case of the concept review we just looked at, it would meet that requirement. But in a case like the Schmaltz application,
Schmaltz would have had to go through a variance process for the setback to the residential units
so
to their south.
They would be here based on proximity to residential. So, I mean, I think this is a good advancement of eliminating special uses where there's not impact to residences in terms of coming through a long process.
And quite frankly, and getting some basic design requirements codified.
Mm-hmm.
We're right now...
Nothing.
We don't have anything.
No. So this is a big improvement, I think. And it still protects, you know, residents in terms of impact from a drive-through, whether it's the speakers or you know, the noise issues that were raised with the Schmaltz application. It still provides protection for those property owners, and it's a good compromise, I think, to advance the uses and at the same time.
I completely agree. Mike, do you think that there's anything additional that could be added and or addressed based upon our discussion during the concept review that just occurred?
No.
Thank you for your answer.
Before we get too far away from it, the explanation you gave, Director Smetana, concerning the numerical-based variation, where is that? I'm looking at 191,
517.15. Oh, you're in a different chapter now.
Oh, variances.
I recall that concept. I'm just struggling to put my finger on it now. And ultimately, the reason I'm asking the question is because for, I guess, all involved, meaning the PZC staff, those members of the public who have concern or may have concern, based on the way that that numerical variation provision reads, I'm wondering if there are certain types of variations that we don't want to permit to be sought on a numerical basis.
So 517.15 establishes the, we'll call it variance process.
Right.
States that variances are intended to provide relief from practical difficulties or unnecessary hardships resulting from strict application of a numerical or quantitative requirement of the zoning ordinance. It further goes on to state that variances cannot be used for the following: to permit a principal use in a zoning district that is not otherwise allowed, also known as a use variance, to waive, modify, or amend any definition or use classification, to waive, modify, or amend any review and approval procedure, or to waive, modify, or amend a condition of approval or requirement imposed by an authorized decision-making body. So it's really driving home the point that the variances are to adjust a numerical or quantitative standard.
Okay, fair. Appreciate that. So the question I was asking then is, can anyone think of an instance where we would not want to allow a variation to be sought in the interest of health, safety, and welfare? And I'm asking the question primarily, if not entirely, because I can think of a number of municipalities. In fact, it seems like it's maybe more often than not that certain things, certain requirements of the zoning code just are not variable. Like there are authorized variations only, and those are the only types of variations you can seek. I'm not necessarily a proponent of that. I'm just expressing the reality of what is out there in the real world. Happy to hear arguments for or against.
I prefer due process.
That's fair.
So since we moved the stormwater provisions out of the zoning code, the variances for things like lot coverage would just still stay the same, right?
So lot coverage is a zoning code provision.
It's a zoning code provision, but the stormwater stuff that was in there is moved out.
The stormwater stuff that was in the zoning code has been moved out, but I will note that that stormwater code, because it adopts the DuPage County Stormwater Ordinance, this body could not hear variances from the stormwater code anyway. It had to go to the village board.
Right.
So.
Okay.
Wait, could not now or cannot under
could
the,
not now.
And cannot.
And cannot in the future.
Great.
DuPage County Ordinance is.
It is
clearly
what it is.
Written that.
Right.
Has to be the village board and the county.
And that's.
We're a partial waiver community.
I think so.
Right, Mike?
Correct.
Yeah.
Is that?
We're a partial waiver community, which means that they don't have to go through the county to have their stormwater plans approved, which means we have to follow the county's rules on how we grant variances, or we lose our partial waiver status, and then the county takes over, which it's a big hassle for people, so that's why.
And that's distinguishable, for example, from a full waiver community where the community handles the approval process entirely on its own?
I don't know if anybody has full waiver, do they?
I don't know that either. I know under partial waiver, we are allowed to review and approve certain stormwater or grading activities, but there are some that still require DuPage County approval. So there are applicants at times working with Lisle's village engineer and DuPage County's stormwater department.
Understood.
My point in all this is we have an agreement with DuPage County that kind of rules this, so.
As a result of DuPage County
giving us the partial waiver.
Exactly.
Yes.
Got it.
Does anybody else have something they'd like to just jump right into?
Yeah, I just have a question on the drive-on through. We mentioned with that last applicant that there was no width.
This code requires a 9-foot width for a single drive-through lane, 10-foot for dual.
Okay.
So under this proposed code, we would look at the drive-through lane width.
Plus the width.
Plus the required drive aisle width for just a normal parking lot.
Okay.
They would not comply with that.
Okay, which would be determined by the angle of the parking space that they take, whether it's 30 or 45 or 60 or.
Let me make sure we maintained that in the proposed code.
It's on page 164, I believe. I don't see any reference to the parking stall.
It's going to be in a different chapter.
Okay.
Commissioner Beavers, that.
I think it's on page 145.
Yes, 145.
So those two provisions we read in tandem.
Correct. You'd have to provide a drive aisle width for the parking spaces plus a drive aisle width for the drive-thru.
Wonderful.
So that's 9 or else 10?
It would be 9 feet plus 14 feet.
Okay. Right.
So they would require 23 feet. They're at 19 feet on their current plan.
All right. Thank you.
But what happens if the angle of parking is something other than those identified on page 145?
I believe that's where staff makes an interpretation.
I mean,
it could happen.
I'm just saying, I think we should have a one-sentence addition, perhaps, that says something to that effect.
So this table is taken directly from the Downers Grove zoning code. And that code did not contemplate that scenario.
Yeah. And then these are the most common parking angles for a parking lot. Because if you change the angle, then a car won't fit.
Well, I mean, based on the discussion we had earlier tonight, the current code apparently permits a 30-degree angled stall.
I don't know that you see that actually applied in the field anymore, though. I mean, I'm just thinking about every parking lot I've been in.
I've never seen one.
If I've ever parked in a
30.
A 30-degree, yeah. I mean, that's very...
Yeah, that's very uncommon.
I can't say that I've seen it either, but I don't walk around with a protractor when I park.
So I tend to agree with your ultimate point. Your ultimate point, I would assume, on the table on page 145 is just putting an asterisk under the note to say that in the event that it doesn't meet these, staff is permitted or zoning administrator is permitted to make a determination based upon the aforementioned.
I think there's a provision at the beginning of the zoning code regarding like rounding up and whether you round up to the next regulatory measure or round down.
I mean, ultimately,
which may cover that.
It's helpful to you to have it right next to the table. So, I don't know if you're in support of that, but. And if we propose any modifications whatsoever to this draft, does that have to be specifically recommended if we're making a motion to approve this draft tonight?
Yes. Yeah, if we're going to change this document from
whatsoever.
I mean, we have to present something that's fully written out. I mean, even if it has a, you know, a addendum to it or something. I do have a quick thing that I'd like to just go over. Special use permits. The new code revision regarding lapse of approval. So a special use gets approved and then nothing happens. Maybe you could kind of just walk us through the revision of the new code in terms of
sure.
What's going to happen if somebody applies for a special use, gets a special use, and then does nothing.
So this was a provision that staff had put forward in the first edition of the draft zoning code. And through the public hearing process, we did receive feedback from an attorney who opposed this type of language in the code. Staff was in favor of the language. The village attorney has not expressed opposition to the language, so it's been reinserted. What this language does is it establishes the requirement that a special use permit be established within 1 year of village board approval. And establishment of that special use permit could take place through issuance of a building permit, a certificate of occupancy, or some other lawful manner. And what it's designed to do is prevent the village from approving a special use permit and not having it established until, you know, 5 years, 10 years down the road when you have new neighboring property owners, new residents in the area who may be caught off guard and not have realized that there was a special use permit approved and just not activated for a decade or more. So this would require that, you know, within that year of county board approval that the special use permit be put to use. Now there's the ability for the applicant to request extensions to that deadline, but it ensures that we don't have a special use permit out there that no one knows about.
Yeah, that timeline is very common in other zoning ordinances.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
And I think this alleviates the village's the village now only would have the process of going through an actual formal revocation proceeding where you'd have to send them notice.
Correct.
They'd have some type of I don't know, I'll say hearing because I don't know if that's the right word or not, but some type
it
of
is.
An appearance before the village board in order to revoke it.
Correct. And what staff would do with this lapse of approval language would be to build it into
the application.
The approving ordinance and applications. So the applicant would know, or at least we could show the applicant should have known that the special use permit or variance would lapse.
And it provides some provisions for extensions.
Yep.
And so there's warning periods, if you would.
Correct.
Okay.
I don't actually believe that this provision requires further village action, further village board action to revoke the, I'll call uninstituted.
No, I'm saying that our code today requires this revocation process.
Got it.
Because we don't have this lapse of approval section in our current code.
Got it.
So right now it requires proactive action by the village to send out notice of revocation.
Whereas this does not.
Whereas this does not.
Got it.
My second question is also related to special uses, but also applies to text amendments. After an application for special use or text amendment comes before the Planning and Zoning Commission and we issue some type of a recommendation on it, the code in both cases says that it, that within 60 days of the Planning and Zoning Commission's recommendation, the village board must act. Is the 60 days something that we're choosing, or is the 60 days a statute?
I'd have to look it up, but I think it's statutory.
I believe that it is in the statute.
Yeah, so my thought is that it's in the statute as well. And so if the 60 days passes without action, what is the next step?
There is a provision. Let me find it.
They're not acted on. They're usually considered denied.
I think it's considered denied, but I just have to find that code section that says that.
So I'm thinking of this simply because we had three parallel applications on the zoning code, and two of them have already been voted on with recommendations. And I don't know when the 60 days is, because we already recommended those, right?
Section 517.7, any time limit specified in this chapter for any decision or action may be extended if the applicant agrees to an extension.
I think it's actually 90 days statutory.
The statute?
I'm trying to look it up now.
So this code says things can be extended, but if the party doesn't agree, then it's denied.
Okay, but can it be extended to something that goes beyond the statute? So let's take an application that gets a recommendation from this board, but then the applicant wants to wait a year to go to the village board.
Well,
I'm making something up.
I don't know that the applicant gets that choice. I mean, as staff, this body has made a recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
Village staff will be forwarding that to the village board.
Within the 60-day period.
Correct. Now, if the applicant approaches the board and says, we'd like to delay this, or, I mean, those parties could agree to that. But this will be, you know, that application would be presented to the board. I mean, I will tell the commission that there's a zoning request that is still technically being considered by the board from 2018. No decision's ever been made on it. It's tabled. And that was a parking lot expansion on Cabot that this commission conducted a public hearing on and voted on.
And it went to the village board?
Correct.
And it was on their agenda?
And no action has been taken.
And they tabled it? And so then what happens? If it's that old, then what happens?
I wouldn't say they tabled it. There was literally no action taken.
Like no motion?
Correct.
So what happens then if that much time goes by?
I think this code addresses that. I don't know that the current...
It's just considered denied?
Correct. The current zoning code, I guess it goes into purgatory.
It piqued my curiosity. Was that the applicant's?
It would have to be, right?
Request or the board's?
I think I know which application you're talking about, right? I mean, now there's somebody just bought the building.
It's denied.
It's denied by virtue of not having been approved within a specified period of time?
Right. Part of the reason of that is some cases dealing with places that just kept dragging out the approval and that you're really denying people due process if you don't have some provision for something being resolved within a reasonable period of time. I'm looking through the statute. I'm actually not sure that the timeframe is statutory.
Okay.
I'm not seeing...
I see 90 days, for example, with respect to adoption or amendment of a comprehensive plan.
Right.
And I think there's a comparable 90-day provision for subdivision approval under the Plat Act.
Yes, there is.
But I don't see anything in the zoning division of the municipal...
Right. It's section 11-13-14. Is that the one you're looking at?
Well, not for the comp plan or subdivision.
No, for the zoning ordinance. That's...
Yes.
Text and map amendments.
Right.
Are 11-13-14, and I'm not seeing a timeframe in there.
And what about for special uses or variations?
But I don't know. You guys asked about text amendments. let me check.
So similarly speaking, there's a requirement on the Planning and Zoning Commission that, you know, once we close a hearing, that we have to act on it within 60 days. So we closed the public hearing for this zoning code at our last meeting, and 30 days have now lapsed. And we would be required to make a recommendation within 60 days.
And I think these kind of timelines, these parameters, I mean, these really benefit the public.
Well, they benefit a lot of people because it doesn't go on forever.
It allows them to keep track of something and...
Right.
Right.
Not have something disappear for 5 years and then all of a sudden be approved.
Well, right. It removes a lot of uncertainty also from even an applicant's perspective that something could be arbitrarily just, you know, discussed forever.
Agreed.
It forces decision-making, and I think deadlines are very beneficial for decision-making.
Yeah, I'm not seeing them anywhere in the statute. I know I always recommend them based on that case law of, you know, possibly being considered denying somebody due process if you don't make a timely decision.
Mm-hmm. I have a couple things. First of all, I you know, taking the time to read back through this, I just want to compliment everybody, even some of our public that comes in here and has helped us with this process, ex-members of this commission, our attorney, staff, unbelievable. I read through this and it is clear, it is concise, it is easier, it's usable. Hats off to everybody. This is a vast improvement. Director Spintana, outstanding job. Outstanding, seriously. That stated, on page 28, and I have two things just for clarification. Community residents, we have the permitted and special use designation. And then if you go over to group living, if you guys could maybe refresh my memory, did we or did we not have some discussions of the, and maybe this was a legal issue that came up that we could not deny? But I don't know if that's as clear as I would like it, because the only thing that I guess prevents having in a residential community a criminal offense community residence, there is no stop. There is no, it's permitted, I guess, unless there's another one located. Is that correct? So that would be referencing page 28 with the chart. And then again on page 35, 5752A. Did we or did we not have a discussion that was different than what this is reading, or is it just me?
I thought there was a...
So this commission had amended at least what was previously presented to be permitted or special use. It's basically carrying over how the village's current zoning code treats community residence facilities, where it's a permitted use unless it's within so many feet of another community residence facility, and then it requires a special use permit.
Right, but I had thought that as a group, we had recommended to take permitted out of R1 and definitely out of R1. Did we not, or am I misremembering?
I don't know that you can arbitrarily do that.
I don't think we can do that. I really don't think we can do that. I mean, legally. I mean, I'm sure our attorney can weigh in here. And I think that the 660 feet separation is probably weak as well, in terms of.
Yeah, how many lots is that? How many?
Yeah, like.
Every four houses you could have a.
Maybe I'll just let Attorney Elliott opine on the distance and where that came from and why it is that way. I mean, I think it's a special use. I don't think it's necessarily something that can be arbitrarily denied. I think that if another community residence came in that was 500 feet away, I think you'd have a hard time denying.
So if I'm reading this right, if I wanted to put specifically that type of community residence in a neighborhood, I am permitted to do so as long as there's not another one 660 feet away. Is that correct?
As long as it fits in with the definition.
Well, yeah, but you have to meet all the building and zoning codes, you know, and the building code limits occupancy, you know.
Lot coverage. I mean, everything. It's not like you can overbuild on an R2 lot to create a big, huge community residence.
This is a federal court issue, and the idea is disabled persons, you know, require somebody
living
to be able to take care of them. So you have to allow a situation where you can have caregivers, you know, 24/7 to take care of them because they're entitled to live in residential areas.
Right, but why wouldn't it just be a special use period? Why would we, is that the
legal
question?
Because if they can meet the requirements, you're putting a requirement on them that you're not putting on non-disabled persons.
Right. Right. It's I think it's strictly illegal.
But this is a community residence. This isn't, you know, this isn't a individual family with somebody with a disability.
But it's to avoid villages from arbitrarily denying housing for disabled residents.
It's a broad definition.
This is an American with Disabilities Act matter.
No, I understand the ADA. I didn't know if group living is a different.
So group living is different than a community residence.
Oh, correct.
Right.
So, okay, that's maybe where I'm having the.
Yeah, I mean, it says does not include.
Okay, maybe that's where I am.
For your reference to criminal offense. I, as you were saying that, though, I do recall an extensive discussion regarding jails not being permitted.
Right.
I was just leafing through to see if it was stricken out like --- across the board with it referenced. I don't believe it's referenced anymore. Because I agree with you, we had a discussion towards jail facility specifically.
I just didn't know what
they're removed from the code.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that they are not permitted in any district?
Jails? Correct. I mean, my thought is if the state decides that they're going to put their next penitentiary in Lisle, Lisle's not going to have much say on the matter. So we can cross that bridge when we get there. But there's no reason to have it in the zoning code right now.
And again, my only concern is allowing residents a voice of what's going on in their neighborhood to say, hey, you know, I don't want this community residence because of X, Y, or Z.
It's going to end up in federal court.
Yeah, I'm you know, I try to keep up on reading on this kind of stuff. It's just a dangerous place to go, I think. You know, I think that when it comes to a residential care home, we're not talking about just a random group of people deciding to live together. We're talking about a residential care home, whether it's physical disability, mental disability, I'll say, you know, medical, as in, you know, drug rehab and all of these things that cause a lot of controversy in neighborhoods. you just find yourself in federal court because the commentary that comes from the public can be questionable. Denying people with disabilities the right to live in a residential neighborhood.
I don't think that it's denying. The ADA has provisions for reasonable accommodation. So all I'm asking is, legally, you're saying that we have to say that it is permitted and then make some qualifiers to say special use if these things exist.
I think that the village can only establish reasonable regulations. And reasonable would be subject to the interpretation of federal court.
Yes. And I do think that there have been, I mean, you know, I think there's one in Hinsdale now, if I recall.
They're in litigation.
They're in litigation. So a group home that, for whatever reason, went through public hearing process, and whether it was proximity or their code, they denied a facility, and now they're in court.
Well, might I ask that we change the located 660 linear feet from an existing or approved? Can that be increased?
I think so.
Where are we getting this 660 linear feet?
From Ansel Glink?
Oh,
I actually think the 660 was from some case. I think this was from, and I don't recall which one, but it was that my recollection, and I'm just going from, you know, here, is it because there are caregivers involved typically coming and going, and there's more traffic, that the distances between them can create more traffic within a neighborhood. And so the distance is justified. I'm not sure 660 is the magic number or something, but my recollection is it did come from some court ruling of separating what's reasonable and when does it start having impact in the neighbors, so that neighbors would have rights.
I pulled the cases, you know, 18 months ago when I reviewed.
Yeah, well, staff. Yes, and I probably read about this, you know, 3 years ago, And because I do remember when the village was considering all of this at one point, and that was probably like in 2017 or something, because somebody wanted to be able to put a facility like this in Lisle, and this wasn't even in our code. And the 660 feet was also part of it. And kind of the question of, well, why have any separation at all? Why can't they be right next to each other? But they can. You just have to have a special use for the second one. I don't think we have too much flexibility
here. Right, the courts have recognized the spacing requirement if you have a provision for the special use.
Mm-hmm.
To, you know, they've recognized that that's going to not violate the reasonable accommodation provision.
Right, because there's many other places to choose. You don't have to choose the one that's right next door to an existing one. And obviously there would be some impacts to the neighborhood.
I certainly understand it. I'm not going to belabor the point. I guess I look at group homes or specialized residential care more as a business. Yes, it's providing a service, but I understand that there's some legal parameters with that. My only request would be just to double or triple check that we're as strict as we can possibly be with that provision.
Well, I can tell you for sure that the federal courts do not consider it a business.
Yeah, that's fine with me. I'm sure they don't, but
I understand what you're saying, and it's not a value judgment. It's an effort to keep the village out of federal
court. Out of litigation.
I understand that. I'm not making one against somebody.
So my suggestion would be that we would leave the language the way it is, maybe this is just makes it to the list of recommendations that goes to a village board, is that that we would look at this as something that would get amended as a standalone text amendment, and then it would be a single item issue that we could address with a little more backup and justification for the numbers. But since it was researched before, and it literally is not a change from our current code, I would suggest we just leave the language the way it is presented to the village board in this fashion with this explanation, and certainly open to, you know, a text amendment in the future that would look at this specific provision.
That's fine. The only thing I would ask is that we just revisit it maybe from a legal standpoint one last time.
Sure.
And see if there's anything that we may have overlooked. And I have one other one that's just, oh, I'm sorry, did you have a comment?
Can I follow up on that while we're on the subject? So community residents on page 28 of the use table, and I didn't notice this as I was going through my packet, it identifies permitted and special use, and then obviously you have your table below. What is permitted? Because I don't see any permitted.
If it's more than 660 feet.
You have to look.
So just across the board?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You have to look at the rightmost column, supplemental regulations. It references 5-7-5-2-A, and that's where the 660 comes from.
Okay.
By the way, Commissioner Trussell, for whatever it's worth, I don't know the answer either about the 660. However, I just did a very fast, quick and dirty internet search, and the internet is replete with 660 linear foot references in reference to community residences.
I'm sure our crack team over there did their job correctly. I just thought I miss was remembering everything here.
I understand the frustration with the federal court rulings, but they are what they are.
Hands are tied, I understand. I just really would like residents to be able to have a avenue, should they choose to, regardless, but.
Well, I mean, I would say that there are avenues with regards to if a community residence was creating too much noise, if, you know, if there was some other impact to the actual use, if it was already established for enforcement from that perspective, i.e. no different than if a family moved in next door and they were loud. Or if a family moved in next door and they were running a home business, that became something that exceeded what we allow for a home business. So I think there are certain protections in there, in addition to things like the building code and everything else being in compliance.
I certainly understand why ADA is needed, and it is there, and I agree with some of that. There is also the rights of residents.
I get it.
I have one last one that's probably just as gray as that one, sorry. Page 174. If you guys could refresh my memory, the anti-monotony standards, didn't we change these numbers, or was it the numbers that we changed to, that it was three, no building permit shall be issued for any new detached house with street-facing facade that is substantially similar to any other detached house within three lots on either side. Does that number sound correct with our discussions? And then four across the street, so two in either direction is how I would read that. Is that correct?
Double check right now for you.
If you're asking if my reading of 516-42A is as you described it, I agree. Is that what you're asking?
I thought we had lessened that. I mean, yeah, I guess I'm torn a little bit. Again, this is another gray one for me, but you know, if you go to B here, you know, you could have the same roof, you could, you know, as long as you have more stories, or you could have the shape of the house be a little bit different. So I guess, you know, two pieces. One, you know, the house could pretty much look exactly the same. So does it really accomplish what we're trying to accomplish here with these rules is one side of my brain. The other side of my brain is not limiting people to say, hey, you know, I like that style of house. Why, you know, I can't build the same style houses because there's another house located that's similar.
Well, it was three and seven originally.
Was it three and seven? Okay. That's what I was.
I think you actually could if you applied for a variance. I mean, if you desperately wanted to build the exact same house as the one next door, but you could just change the primary and accent building materials, make it, you know, like, i.e. different color brick or whatever, you know, or reorient the garage and whatever. And I think you'd be there. I don't know that it's really all that difficult.
But can you please restate your three and seven reference? What are you referring to?
My original question.
The seven. Original proposal was within three lots on either side and within seven of the nearest lots across the street. So we reduced that at Commissioner Trussell's request to three and four.
Okay, thank you. What I was actually asking earlier, pertains to 2B, and that is, I seem to recall that at Commissioner Trussell's suggestion, we also reduced.
Did that required 4, and now it's dropped down to 2. Mm-hmm. So it's less, it's more forgiving than.
Less onerous, yeah.
Correct, what was initially proposed.
Just so you understand, Commissioner Trussell, that's what I was actually initially asking. I don't actually recall modifying 2A, you know, at your suggestion or anybody's suggestion, but I do distinctly recall at your suggestion making 2B more flexible to be accommodating to, you know, homeowners.
Yeah, and that's why I said B looked, you know, reasonable to me on one half, and then, you know, can I get three across the street, 2 on either side?
I'm sure with the commission that that provision, I mean, it didn't come from Western Springs or Hinsdale or Burr Ridge. It's from New Lenox.
Okay. I mean, I don't know how much, this is all new build, correct?
Correct.
Okay, yeah. Yeah,
building permit. So, I mean, anything that would come in that would be a building permit at this point might be an infill house. You know, what are the odds it's going to be exactly like the one next door? Probably not. My suggestion is in an effort to try and move this this version to the village board for their consideration is that we would leave it the way it is, because it doesn't seem unreasonable. And I think a brand new subdivision would then incorporate these if they were, you know, building, you know, 20, 30, 40 houses.
No, but I was asking a question of whether I was remembering this correctly. And Director Spintak.
I don't really think we should change it from what it is.
I'm sorry?
I don't think we should change it from the way it's presented.
I don't disagree.
Okay, good.
I was just asking as my notes that was it that what we discussed, so.
For whatever it's worth, the only thing I can think of where, you know, these types of provisions would be implemented would either be in a new development scenario, like Commissioner Zidell referenced, or otherwise, you know, as part of teardowns. And I, you know, happen to live south of the Village Hall here where there's been teardown activity over the past decade plus. And I can actually only think of maybe one instance where homes within this, you know, proximity to each other perhaps violate this type of architectural anti-monotony standard. So my point is, I don't actually think it's going to be an issue.
We have a lot of monotony in certain segments of Lisle, but this would be a new detached house, so not a remodel of or that. So I'm fine with everything here.
In terms of approving this draft, if there's anything clerical, for instance, adding a space between 4 and 5 on 2B, how does that work? I don't want to spend
staff's going to keep correcting clerical grammatical errors.
So rather than waste the time of this commission, if I sent Director Smetania an email that said, hey, might want to remove this hyphen or add a colon or add this, I can save the commission
that
time.
Take a red pen, circle, and send them a book.
Well, I have flags, and it's nothing substantive. It's really like, you know, hey, maybe you want to put the word shall here, add a little something at the end as a catch-all to assist the village. So I can submit that via email after the fact. The only substantive thing that I wanted to bring up was in relation to the email that we received on September 15th from the Economic Development Commission, or Economic Development Partnership. Ultimately, I wanted to hear staff's response to that letter in addition to the fellow commissioners in terms of the changes that they were proposing to the use table and the definition of the OR research district purpose.
So what I will tell the commission is that both myself and the village manager's office will ask the village board emphatically to approve what the commission has recommended. If the LEDP or other members of the public wish to make further modifications to the zoning code, they can do so through a text amendment process. And they can also participate in a comprehensive plan rewrite, which will probably be the next activity the village takes on. But myself and the village manager's office will be advocating that the village board approve the draft plan as recommended by this body.
So I think that the content of their letter includes stuff that we actually addressed during the course of this process. I mean, the process started with authorization in 2019. This has been a 2-year-plus process so far. You'll recall that it was probably in around October, November, December, at the end of 2020, when we started going through matching up the purpose statements in the zoning code to match the comprehensive land use plan. And that was at the time we sent it back to the village board for confirmation that the zoning code would advance the current comprehensive land use plans. That was the 2004 village-wide comp plan, the downtown, the 2018 downtown plan, and the 2010 Ogden plan. And so some of these proposed changes were eliminated based on directive that the zoning code should advance the existing comp plans. So for example, the purpose statement of the OR district being revised from the comp plan puts in a disconnect, right? Like, so we're not advancing what's been established as the comp plan, we'd be advancing some unestablished plan. Same with proposed revisions in downtown. If the downtown plan contemplates certain uses and certain goals, if the zoning code is not consistent with that plan, then, you know, so I think that the recommendations that they have in there were addressed during our very long process by lots of people that came here. I mean, we had property owners specifically come and address the OR changes. We had, you know, then they brought an attorney with them that reviewed the whole entire code. And I think that those kind of changes can be contemplated, but not until after we've done a revised comprehensive land use plan. I mean, I don't think they're off the table. I think they're off the table for now.
And have they come and with these suggestions probably during the process?
Well, I think maybe when it was like last, you know, like I said, November, December of 2020, when we had, you know, hearings and people here talking about these exact issues, you know, at that particular time, having that, you know, input from the public and understanding the dynamic of what was happening at that time. And again, when it was sent to the village board for clarification and to affirm what the project was, you know, I think the organization is rather new and perhaps not fully established at the time we were going through this. And so they're kind of coming to this very long process, very much at the end, maybe not understanding the level of community input that existed throughout this whole process. And I think that what we have in front of us now is based on the task that was laid out in front of us. So I mean, I appreciate all the comments and everything, but I do think that comes after we get through this part and we do that comprehensive land use plan. And then that becomes another whole big public process.
So if I'm hearing you correctly, we're conforming with the plans that are in existence. There will be a more appropriate forum for these issues
after,
to be debated.
After
to
we first revising the comp plan.
That makes sense to me.
And it sounds to me like that there's a pretty solid consensus now on that the 2004 comprehensive land use plan will begin an updating process.
In 2022, 2023.
In 2024, it'll be another 2-year process.
Got enough writing.
Well, it could be a long process. I mean, it depends, right? The level of community engagement. Does anyone else have anything else they would like to go through? Oh, Carl. Come on down.
And toward that end, I'll submit an email of some clerical minor things that I had to Director Smetana.
I appreciate the assistance with grammar.
No problem, sir.
I'm never even sending you an email. I'm just not. I'll get it back.
Just a point of order. I think we need a motion to extend beyond 10, right?
Yeah, can I have a motion? I'll say, if you have anybody's agreeable, a motion for a 30-minute extension.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Madam Chair and Commissioners, been a long, long time, and I assume at this point that the commission is about to make a recommendation with respect to the final draft, that you will be recommending something that will go to the Board of Trustees and the mayor for action by them. I assuming that you are about at that point this evening, that you plan on considering a motion.
We certainly could.
To recommend that it be sent to the village board.
We certainly could do that, yeah.
Okay, so it looks like that's where you're going?
It's possible.
Okay, thank you. With respect to the comments earlier made by Commissioner Trussell, and I did look at the minutes from the last meeting, and I think the contents of the meeting really glossed over my comments relative to the activities, the time spent, the expertise, all of that. And I think it deserves a definite action by the mayor and the Board of Trustees with respect to the activities, the time, all of that that has been spent by the commissioners and by the two people sitting to my right as well, and I could throw in the recording secretary as well. But I think that people that haven't been involved in what you've done understate, criticize, or whatever it is, and don't recognize what the heck you guys have done. So now that you're at the point where you're ready to make a final recommendation, hopefully what I say isn't going to be construed by others as saying, well, you got what you want, whatever it is. So that's why I'm saying that. That isn't the purpose of what I said. And I wanted to come from an outsider person that has been at, along with Ms. Bartelli, I think we've been at almost every public hearing, and I'm sure you've gotten to look at us and go, here they are again. But I wanted to emphasize, and I hope it's in the minutes, that the mayor and the Board of Trustees owe a spoken, written acknowledgement relative to the activities of the five of you, as well as these two professionals over here. It's easily overlooked, and there's nothing to it. So I wanted to make that clear. And a couple of other comments, but I don't want to muddy the water and delay any further where you're about to go. The last meeting, I raised the issue relative to noise, and I did look at that again. I understand a disturbing the peace or a nuisance or whatever it is. I'm looking primarily at performance standards within the residential district. And I guess the question I have would be, is the noise that would emanate from a residential district the noise coming from a residence or any facility within a residential district? You follow me in what I've asked?
Director Smetana, do you think you can answer that?
And I'm not trying to outsmart anybody, just to...
No.
I'm going to try to answer that once I actually read the code provision.
Uh-huh. And if you could
I can go to another one and come back. Mike, if that's, you'd rather do that.
Noise shall be measured at the property line of the parcel from which the noise is generated.
So it sounds like...
Okay, so but my point then is that within the residential district or within a residence only within the residential district. What's the answer?
It's 55 decibels during the daytime, 50 decibels at nighttime.
Well, that's the standard, but I'm talking about, is it from a residence only within a residential district, or is it from...
It's land use.
Something, so it's within the...
It's what the land use is on the property. Mm-hmm. So no zoning districts.
So.
So it's the land use.
Then my point is, if you take a look at the table, and I think there, the table seems to me, and I don't know enough to compare to what we had, but it seems to me that, the difference between the residents and other districts, day and night, is alarmingly narrow. But again, I remember the PhD that was here with respect to Becky's and what he said, Bucky's, I mean, sorry. And so I'm only concerned about, does that table adequately describe and provide appropriate protection coming out of a facility within a residence district? So that's day and night, and the difference is kind of a narrow scope. But again, I'm not a noise expert. Perhaps Commissioner Bauer, who's done a lot of work in this area, and would know more.
So I will share with everyone that these decibel levels, really all the code language came from Downers Grove and Naperville, and it's more or less modeled after them. You know, to me, this is a very technical field. If we really wanted to take a deep dive into what really should the noise level be at a residential property line, we would have to bring in a consultant. I mean, otherwise, I'm just borrowing from other jurisdictions what they have on the books and assuming that there has not been issues.
Okay, but with those comments, I believe it's an area that would have will have to be looked at in the future and perhaps considered appropriate at a future date. And the other question I had relative to residential parking within the residential district, talked about five cars within in the driveway, not in an enclosed building. So my question is, you see these canvas type parking structures in people's driveways, are those considered enclosed buildings? And if from a zoning viewpoint, but from a building code viewpoint, what are the standards relative to those installations? They see several around town, and I find them interesting, but how are they governed or regulated? I have no idea.
So I would say that with a structure like that, to you know, initially you don't even think about the zoning code. It's a building code issue.
Yes, I understand.
If it's fabric, it likely does not meet the wind and snow load requirements for this area, and it was probably built without a building permit.
So from the standpoint of a zoning interpretation, they would be considered an enclosed building?
We wouldn't get to a zoning code interpretation because it would be a violation of the building code, and they'd be told to remove that structure from the driveway.
Okay, thank you. So it would not be then considered an enclosed building from the viewpoint of the parking in unenclosed.
Really more like it's
whatever you want to call them. Did I understand that correctly?
The parking, I'm sorry to step on your toes if that's what's happening, but in my view, the issue of parking really becomes moot because whether this structure that you're speaking of is located in a driveway or instead in the side yard or the rear yard of a home, in the end, that structure is itself not permitted. So the fact that there's a vehicle parked under it, especially if it's off of the driveway, is not permitted. Is that a fair statement, Director Smetana?
Correct.
So the car that's underneath a structure like that is one of five.
Okay, then the other thing.
If you're allowed five on your driveway and one of them is covered with an illegal fabric tent, that car is one of the five from a zoning perspective.
Yeah, if it's even parked in a place on your property where parking
is allowed.
Is permissible.
Right. So if we say you can have five on your driveway and there's a, you know.
So it's been clarified. And mm-hmm. I said something that I think will have to be looked at from a daily viewpoint rather than from the commissioner's mm-hmm. interest as well. And the other part of it, I think in the future could be looked at is the specifications, et cetera, relative to the width of driveways and how it's measured and how much of the front yard, for example, can be occupied by a driveway. I noticed that the width of the driveway is measured at the lot line. I've seen in a neighboring town a driveway that comes, it's wide, and it comes out within a foot of the property line and then goes 90 degrees over to the 24-foot line, and then it's wider than heck. And so my point is that five cars takes a substantial amount of room, especially when you have driveways that are short, especially in the newer homes with very, very short driveways. And the other ones that the older homes sometimes have a longer one. But this is an alert that I think in the future, perhaps that issue perhaps should be looked at, especially from an inspection viewpoint, not daily, but whatever is necessary, perhaps should be something that would not pertain to you, except relative to possible changes with respect to the width of driveways, et cetera. So my point is, I think I brought it to your attention, but I'm not asking at this point that you delay your action, and hopefully the Board of Trustees will, and the mayor will acknowledge your efforts and will take a look at the code as a culmination of a lot of time. Another issue that was raised by, I believe, the commissioner had to do with a procedural happening or what's going on with respect to development. And I'm concerned that it appears to me as an old bystander that the job or the responsibility of the Plan Commission with respect to formal applications, et cetera, is kind of being walked around around the Plan Commission with respect to focus groups and meetings and kind of, I think, being done. Maybe it's my interpretation relative to the issue, but it's kind of being done without the matter being submitted at a public hearing where the people know what the request is. And I think there's a focus group next Tuesday, I believe it is. And I'm alarmed at the input that perhaps is totally overrides the obligation of the statutory or the responsibility of the statutory board. And there's kind of a buy-in before it's submitted formally with respect to the request. And I'm concerned about that. And perhaps you don't have to comment about it now, but I see that as a problem that's occurred relative to one parcel in town that's gone on for 5 years. Application has never been submitted. That's alarming to me that it's being bandied about. They're having focus groups, invitation from the village letterhead today evidently about this focus group next Tuesday. Maybe I'm wrong on that, but I'm concerned that why bother having a commission if we're going through, I'm going to say, the side door, not illegally, but I'm not impressed with that procedure. And I think it can lead to some abuses and pressure being put forth by agencies that don't have the statutory authority and responsibility that you do. So with that in mind, I won't comment any further except to thank you for your efforts and the director, the village attorney, and all of you up there. Thank God for you. We really appreciate it. Thank you very much, and appreciate the long time that you've spent listening to me and very few others, as a matter of fact. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
If I can, Mr. Doerr, before you sit down, I just want to make sure to thank you and Ms. Bartelli, who, in my observation, have unquestionably, at least as a resident, spent more time than apparently anyone else who at least has physically attended and expressed interest in this process. So on behalf of, you know, myself and I suppose my peers, thanks very much for your interest.
But it's interesting to see professionals at work. And I'm not saying that to make you feel good. I'm saying that because it's true. You watch the Cubs the way they were this year. It hasn't been too enjoyable. You watch them in 2016, that was. And I'm saying this group, with what you've done, is similar to the Cubs in 2016. Thank you.
As a Sox fan, maybe I'll...
Not a Sox fan, I can't talk about them.
Carol and Carl, I'd like to reiterate that as well. I thank you for the kind words and your time, and I'd also support your comments in regard to Director Smetana and the village attorney as well. Thank you.
And I did mention the recording secretary as well.
Oh, yes, as well.
Thank you.
Everyone involved.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Is there anything else from the commission in terms of comments on this final draft? If not, I'm going to ask for a motion.
And there's no further recommendations based on the discussion
we've
had this evening?
We can have additional recommendations, I think, in terms of the stuff we did not do. You know, some of the things we talked about was, you know, the recommendation for the update to the comprehensive land use plan, which I think is a suitable recommendation coming from this body. Some of the things that could be addressed outside of the zoning code, I mean, I'll use the one example that we had a reasonable conversation about food trucks and pulled it all out of the zoning code and determined that that should be really a business regulation. That recommendation to the village board to establish those kind of business regulations. I'm just a couple of examples, but you know, we certainly can make those recommendations along with this.
And I guess the reason for my question was I didn't hear anything substantive this evening that should necessarily be added. So before a motion was rendered, I just figured I'd put that up for discussion.
Good to go.
Okay.
Do you want to, if you're contemplating a motion, do you want to make some sort of reference to the grammatical or formatting sentence structure type comments that you alluded to earlier?
Yes. Yeah, I think you should put it in the motion.
And this is, just to clarify here, all we'd be recommending is, or I guess I'll just go into it. So I would make a motion pursuant to PZC 2020-14 for approval of a comprehensive amendment to Title V of the Lisle Village Code zoning regulations. Subject to any further clerical modifications as determined to be reasonable by staff. That's sufficient?
I understand the intent.
Yeah, we're talking about, you know,
and then do you need a reference to any form of a draft or just to what is being proposed under this?
Does it have draft number? Just this code?
That's what I was looking for.
It doesn't. I would state the draft is presented the October 20th Planning and Zoning Commission meeting.
Today's draft, whatever it is. Because it's all
right.
Not dated.
I'll restart that then. PZC 2020-14, I would make a motion for approval of the comprehensive amendment to Title V of the Lisle Village Code zoning regulations as presented on October 20th, 2021, subject to any clerical modifications deemed necessary by staff.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? If not, we'll do a roll call.
Commissioner Nakamura?
Aye.
Commissioner Trussell?
Aye.
Commissioner Biederstadt?
Aye.
Vice Chairman Bauer?
Aye.
Chairman Zeidel?
Aye. And the Zoning Code Rewrite Project moves forward to the Village Board with a unanimous vote of the Planning and Zoning Commission. Is there anything else at this point? Maybe we could have a brief discussion of the status of our commission training.
It was discussed at Village Board, and I don't know that a time frame was set up. I think it was discussed for early next year. They are looking at hiring. Go ahead, the APA person.
We are looking at November 8th, having a special meeting, a joint notice for this commission, and with the invite extended to village board members. So the APA could do a zoning training workshop with everyone. It will likely be, if we move forward with November 8th, it will likely be conducted off-site. at either a park district facility, library district, or school district facility. This room is being used that night, as is the boardroom at the police department.
Off-site, but in the village of Lisle?
Correct. Just not here at Village Hall.
Director, who all would be invited to this, again?
The public could attend. It's a meeting. But the invite would be extended to this commission and village board members.
What about the economic?
They're more than welcome to attend.
Can we give them a formal invite?
Sure.
Thank you.
I guess I'll ask for availability. Is everyone available to make a special meeting on November 8th?
Set the date and I'll move things around, so.
I'm just, you know, no point in having it if no one shows up.
Correct.
Already have it in the calendar.
Okay.
I am now. What's the purpose, however? I mean, I understand conceptually.
The village board directed staff to provide this training to the commission. So staff is trying to get that completed before the holidays.
To the commission, but with the village board's participation?
We suggested they participate and they agreed.
Mm-hmm.
Makes sense to me.
I'd like to thank you for arranging that.
Yeah, no, it's a complete process, and we're just one part of the process. And, you know, I think it's helpful in all decision-making to understand the full process. Okay, so November 8th, off-site, and some type of recording for not only people who can't make it, but for future appointees of the board, I'm assuming?
Correct.
Okay. And does anyone else have anything else they want to bring up? Then a motion to adjourn, please.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned.